I'm really proud to announce that the World Taekwondo Federation are now creating the Taekwondo Humanitarian Foundation. This body will take Taekwondo, which is an easily deployable sport requiring minimal equipment, into refugee camps worldwide to promote physical fitness and mental self-belief, and eventually keep them become global citizens.
Taekwondo is more than a sport.
Thank you. sport for everybody tonight, to be honest with you, but certainly two British athletes that will be with us, because this is the middle day of the World Taekwondo Grand Prix 2017 here in London. We've had over 200 elite athletes from around the world join us here in London, from 56 different countries, all gaining ranking points and, of course, hoping to become new Grand Prix champions. We have 8 Grand Prix champions crowned, 3 last night. We have 3 brand new Grand Prix champions last night. They are from Jordan, Ahmed Abugash, from Korea, Ik Kyo Dong, and from Great Britain, Laura Williams. We also had silver medalists last night. Bradley Sindham got a silver, Conor Brad, and a bronze from Mohammed Shell. We've got to make loads of noise for that, by the way. Mohammed's going to be joining me at the commentary position a little bit later on. It's time to welcome our tank into the arena. Now, tank, we've taken to the Grand Prix on a number of occasions. It's a bit of fun, and we have various clubs from around the country. Tonight, we've got Ultimate Taekwondo from South Yorkshire. You can be with Yorkshire in the house. And we have a representative from London Team. This is a children's event, so let's welcome them into the arena. And first, let us welcome Ultimate Taekwondo from South Yorkshire. Children's event, let us welcome into the arena the London Teams. So the way we play Taekwondo is very simple indeed. We have 2 rounds, 5 minutes each round. The first round, each one of these athletes, young athletes, will get 1 minute on the court. They have 1 minute on court, then they come off and tag another athlete and so on. When we get to the second round, it's mayhem, because literally it's every man for himself. As they put the card in and replace the athlete. As simple as that. For those of you new to the sport of Taekwondo, look over the screens right now and we're going to show you the rules of the sport. How to score in Taekwondo. The Takers, by the way, as well. They get everywhere in this venue. If you get a chance to have a selfie with a Taker, do it and then get it up on Twitter, #KickingForGlory, and and you might be featured on the screens a little bit later on. Okay, give these kids plenty of encouragement. This is a children's taekwondo event. It's Ultimate Taekwondo South Yorkshire against London teams. Referee, please start the contest. That was something of fun, wasn't it? What about that? They were really going for it. Give them a big cheer. Come on, everybody. Wow. Let's have you lined up for your medals. We've got some medals for you guys. Let's have you lined up now for your medals. Are we lined up ready for your medals? Okay. Claire, would you mind doing the honors? First of all, silver medals, of course. Sir, can we have you here for the medals? Silver medals and gold medals, don't let them disappear. You've got medals to have. Look, these are the gold, these are the silver, okay? First and foremost, give a big cheer for the, in blue, the London team. Gold medals, of course, go to Ultimate Taekwondo from South Yorkshire. Once again, London teams and Ultimate Taekwondo. Give them a big cheer as they leave the arena. Well done, guys. Brilliant. Well done. There's a certain young lady in competition tonight. Look to the screens. You might just recognise her.
See through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror. What do you see? Do you see it clearer, or are you deceived? In what you believe, 'cause I'm only human after all, and you're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me, don't put your blame on me. Mean a lie and beg for forgiveness for making you cry, for making you cry. 'Cause I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put the blame on me.
Two volunteers to come down onto the mat. Come on, right, let's have the youngsters. Right, Come on, just send me two down quickly. Come on, one at the front here. Okay, one. Oh, we've got a young lady and this young lad down here. Okay. All right. Come on, come and join us. Come on through the gates here. Okay, I need two of you. That's all we need on. Come on, quickly, quickly, come on. We've got to get through this very, very quickly because we've got a very special gentleman about to join us, the president of the World Taekwondo Federation. Right, you might want to take your boots off. Okay, got the UGG boots. All right, okay. Right, come on down here. This is a relay race. Okay, we've got some chocolates for the winner. Great, great. Right, come stand here. Okay? You want to stand there. What's your name?
Tiana Harriet, sir.
Tiana. Tiana and?
Avon.
Where are you from?
I live here, but I was originally from Slovenia, sir.
Slovenia? Give her a round of applause for Slovenia.
South London.
South London boy. Okay. Very quickly, here's the rules, what we do. You pick a ball up, you put it on the cone. You come back, you pick another ball up, you put it on that cone. You come back, you pick another ball up, you put it on the third cone. You go all the way down to the five cones. Then you run back here. You start back from here, and what you've got to do, you've got to go down, hopping on one leg, doing it taekwondo style, and kicking the ball off. Do you understand? Yes? Okay, all right. You kick the ball off, you go on to the next one. Hopping down, you can't put both feet down, you hop all the way down, you get to the end, and it's the first one that moves back in the centre and kicks the big one off. Got it? Have we got it? Are we standing by? Give them some encouragement, here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, here we go. I'm sure we can stretch the two boxes of chocolates, get them both. And well done, congratulations. All right, well done. You know how to get out through that gate, yeah? Give them a round of applause. So, very shortly indeed, we're going to be joined by the president of the World Taekwondo Federation, Dr. Cho. I do believe he's on his way now. We're just going to clear the arena now. Volunteers to get the cones off the arena, please, and then we can go into the interview with Dr. Cho. Who have we got coming up tonight? Just remind me, have we got any Great Britain athletes? Yes, we have. I think we might have Bianca Walker. And I think we also might have Jay Jones. And give a real big cheer for the President of the World Taekwondo Federation, Dr. Chunwon Cho. Face each other because the camera's there and it's live online and the crowd are there and they're live. Trust me, they're very live. Are you live? Yeah. They're very much alive, Dr. Cho. First of all, I've got to say welcome home because this must be like the home of the Grand Prix. First one was here, wasn't it, in Great Britain?
Yes, thank you for inviting me, and I feel like I'm being home, and also I feel like I'm in India participating in the London Olympic Games in Taekwondo. So I'm very happy to be here.
And you must trust us a little bit by putting events on because you've trusted us with the Grand Prix this year, the Grand Prix next year in Manchester, and then in 2019 in Manchester, the World Championships.
Indeed, I think really, Great Britain is taekwondo loving country. I remember the Manchester is the first ever Grand Prix event was held in Manchester.
And then we moved on. We moved on. We've the event here in London, and a very exciting time because it was para taekwondo for the first time, running up of course to taekwondo making its debut in 2020.
Indeed, so the 7th World Para Taekwondo Championships here in London is the largest ever and biggest ever and most successful events for para taekwondo. And we are very happy and we are very excited to participate in the first ever Paralympic Games in Tokyo 2020.
And tell me a little bit about the developments within Taekwondo, because you've got this humanitarian foundation, the Taekwondo Humanitarian Foundation. I know it's very close to your heart. Just tell us a little bit about it.
Yes, after the success of the London Olympic Taekwondo competition, and we had a wonderful Chelyabinsk World Championships in 2015. After that, so I was thinking, so as an Olympic sport, we should have some contribution to the human society. That's why Taekwondo is the right space to support refugee kids, to give them hope and dreams through our sport. We are not teaching only Taekwondo, we are bringing educational program to refugee camp to teach young children. Importance of world peace, importance of Olympism, and moreover, we are teaching them how to live as a good global citizen. This is what we are bringing to refugee camp to young children.
Wonderful. Just to tail off there, Dr. Cho, and it's a great foundation. What are your hopes for the future for Taekwondo? Because it seems to be growing around the world.
I think we are the most fast evolving sports as an awesome Olympic sport. Taekwondo, we change. We are starting from the old Asian Korean martial arts. Now many people thinking that it's not Taekwondo, Taekwondo. So we are introducing and we are adapting the technology to our Asian martial arts. So we are the most best growing sports in every corner of the world. Actually, we have 209 member nations and plus one. Why plus one? Because we are the first international federation accepting refugee athletes to participate in Olympic Games. So we are very proud of this decision through our all the generous.
Well, Dr. Cho, thanks for being with us. Thanks for being on the mat. Looking forward to tonight's competition. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the World Taekwondo Federation, Dr. Chungwon Cho. Well, this event is brought to you in association with World Taekwondo, UK Sport, Booyah, Mayor of London, Asgroup, 12Bet, Dado, GB Taekwondo, Kukiwa, and British Taekwondo. Well, the British Taekwondo athletes are backed by UK Sport and the National Lottery. There are more world-class sporting events taking place across the UK this year. If you want to find out more, then search UK Sports Events. Everyone who plays the National Lottery is helping to support British athletes and bring world-class events to the UK. Find out more at uksport.gov.uk.
Can't make it. explosion and all those things I didn't say.
Just about time left to tell you about this up here. That's Twitter. Kicking for glory is the hashtag that you need to do. Get some tweets on there tonight if you've got a Twitter account. Get up there, get some pictures taken, some selfies, and we'll feature Twitter a little bit later on. Who's up there now? Oh, do you recognise those two? Oh, it's one, it's Jade in a mirror. Look like two from here. All sorts of different people have been tweeting up there. That's one from GB Taekwondo, Gary Hall and Dr. Cho there, as you can see. So the hashtag Kicking for Glory is the important one. Now, very soon, we're going to go live to 90 countries around the world. When we do, I want you to go deathly quiet for a very short period of time. And that's the only time tonight I want you to be quiet. You'll see the opening TV credits come up on screen. Then the camera comes to me to do the opening to the 90 countries around the world. Following that, we will go to a little bit of a chat with Muhammad. Muhammad Charles with me. We'll have a chat with Muhammad, and then we'll be ready to go into our live show tonight, which of course features, first off, Jay Jones is up first. And number five, semi-final number five, is Bianca Walker. When I say this is London, just blow the roof off, do me a big favour and tell the world how loud London can be. Only when I say this is London. Don't do it when I say welcome to London. This is London, that's what you blow the roof off. started in Moscow, moved on to Morocco, and now it is the United Kingdom's turn to play host. Over 200 elite athletes are here in London, 200 elite athletes that are hoping to be future Grand Prix champions. We've got world champions and we've got Olympic champions. We're now live to 90 countries around the world as we say welcome to this wonderful, vibrant capital city. This is London!
Well, hello and a very warm welcome. It's day number two, a packed arena here in the Copper Box. And the reason for that, heavy British interest in the heaviest weight category of all. Brankia Walton and, of course, Jade Jones as well, going for Grand Prix Golden Glory here. And, of course, Sarah Stevenson running the rule over this one. A pleasure to have you with us, Sarah. Looking forward to tonight.
Thank you for having me. I'm very much looking forward to tonight.
Well, lots of action. The crowd, too, pumped and amped and ready for this one. And this is the menu of choice for us, the under 57 kilogram semis, men's 58s, and then up into the heavyweight females. Well, heavyweight men served up a classic. Will the women do the same? Lots to look forward to. And in just a few moments, it will be Olympic champion Jade Jones on the mat against Tatiana Kudashova. And of course, if you're new to the sport, this is how you score the points in Olympic taekwondo. Well, that's how you score. Can these athletes do it? Great Britain, Russia, Poland and Korea going in the semi-finals. Jade Jones and Tatiana Kudashova up first. Adamkiewicz against Earum. They will make up the second semi-final as both fighters go for gold here. And of course, the preeminent favourite coming into this one, Jade Jones of Great Britain, Tatiana Kudashova, no slouch herself. And Sarah, this one is eagerly anticipated as the athletes make their way out. Double Olympic champion and a couple of nice mascots as well.
Yeah, very cute there. That little one, I think, is Jade's cousin. With him, I know he's very nervous, little Charlie.
Yep, little Charlie Tubby looking nervous, waving away there, happy to be here. But equally happy to be here, Tatiana Kudashova. Can she get herself into her first ever Grand Prix final? Flanked by Abigail Low Ireland. Big moments for the family there. President's Cup champion. Has she got the power?
We shall see. I don't think this crowd would like to see that, but the crowd very, very excited to see Jade coming out. It's nice to have her out first. Keep them warm for the rest of the competition. And for match number five, Bianca Walton as well.
Well, as you said, the crowd eagerly anticipating this one. The athletes, they'll have their game plans ready. And all the pleasantries complete. Big occasion fighter, Jade Jones. As you mentioned, that double Olympic championship glory. World bronze medalist crept up with a silver in Moscow. Can she go one better here, Sarah?
I think she'd like to, obviously, on home soil. And as we've seen before, on home soil, Jade really likes to pull something out of the bag. So this is where she thrives. She loves this environment. The crowd will spur her on. So hopefully this will be a big outcome for Jade.
No question. Trying to stymie the output and ambitions of Jones, Tatiana Kudashova. As I said, ninth in Rabat in Morocco, so that's the biggest occasion for her. So under the lights here, the big occasion. Jade Jones will be trying to put the pressure on early. And last minute bits of coaching advice, just clarifying exactly what the coach is saying.
Yeah, Jade likes to talk a lot. The coach likes a lot of encouragement. She likes someone to talk her through everything. It's just her way of being reassured and feeling confident. So I'm sure they've got that relationship there. And they're used to it now.
No question. She's got the process, she's got the plan. Has she got the power to launch herself into the Grand Prix final? This is the first semi-final of day number two. Well, day number one served up plenty of classic action. Sure, Lauren Williams delighted with her gold. Zhu Linfang, former Chinese athlete and now referee, so she knows her way around the mat. 3 times 2 minutes. And Jade Jones, well, she's so confident she doesn't even need a gum shield.
I was just about to say, I like the way she ran into the ring, very confident, being there first, and then she's had to go back and get the gum shield. She's ready though, she looks ready. They both look ready and very excited to be in this semi-final.
Well, the silence gives way to the storm. Jade Jones straight in with a big push kick, tries to flick one upstairs straight away. Kudashova, no slouch herself, both in that close stance, but the push kick of Jade changing up nicely, Sarah.
Yeah, she's well up for this match. You can see straight away, a few body shots, a few head shots, just kind of warning Kudashova off there.
Lovely little push kick there, and the crowd loving it.
Yeah, she was trying there to score the push, and she's got it there now. Very good in the clinch from Jade Jones there.
Well, you can hear the atmosphere, everyone really loving this. Jade Jones doubles up her score, thought about a headshot. Lovely response from Kudashova.
To be honest, for me, Kudashova was holding there before the headshot.
And Jade Jones intimated that to the coach there, but the coach deciding not to play it, so Kudashova has the merest of advantage halfway through the first round.
Jade still keeping the pressure on there, almost as if it was a start again. Okay, let's start again, let me put the pressure back on, let me use my stabbing kick, is what she likes to do a lot, to the body, then take it high.
And that stabbing shot, as Sarah says, the front leg just keeping Kudashova occupied, and it is a good score for Jones. Lands it cleanly and switches it up nicely as well. Well, she was 3 points down and she's 3 points up with 30 seconds left. Well, a fantastic atmosphere, of course, in the copper box. Jade Jones firing the headshot in. And we'll get a little chance to discuss her tactics during the break here. But Tatiana Kudashova, well, she hasn't had a chance for a break. Very much on the back foot now, the Russian. Confidence ebbing away, likewise the time. And in terms of a good start from Jones, she's stymied the interest of Kudashova, looking strong, and a decent round there.
Yeah, great round from both athletes, but I think Kudashova there got potentially a little bit lucky there in the short distance. Maybe made Jade think a little bit about what she needs to do and refocused. She got a couple of points back up, so I think Jade has the edge a little bit over Kudashova, has that confidence.
As you were saying there, Sarah, rightly, she's got the edge, she's got the score in front. Let's have a little listen in. Well, hard to hear the instructions. Jade Jones looks confident, though. Helped over the barrier. Can she get herself past Kudiana Kudashova here? And the Russian, well, she doesn't have her problems to seek as we go into this second round here. We saw an aggressive start from Jade Jones. I'm guessing we might see similar.
She's ready again, you know, straight in the ring, first in the ring, confidence. Nice little spin there by Jade. Unfortunately, no score, but a gamjun for Kudashova for falling over. So a nice little point there for Jones as well.
Kudashova falling over. You've started your rhyming already.
It's match one.
And she's no match at the moment for her. Kudashova, lovely little push kick again. It's that savage back kick round the corner from Jones. Doesn't land, but gives Kudashova lots to think about. And the cover game of Jade Jones, a little bit underrated, but she's good on the open distance, not so much on the close.
Yeah, she struggled. She seemed to struggle a little bit in that really close distance when they're nearly chest to chest. Nice push kick over there. 2 points and a gamjung for Kudashova, so a comfortable lead for Jones. And a great back kick, good timing.
And it is, of course, perfect timing to have the extra point added on for the back kick. So great momentum here for Jade Jones. Tatiana Kudashova, 12 points down.
Excellent round from Jones. She's really back in form now. She's very, very confident. I think she'll be happy with that lead then going into the third round.
Yep, you mentioned on the way into this one, the bronze and the silver, can she turn it into gold? Well, Tatiana Kujo, as you said, left a little space in that close distance, so something to work on, but working on the scoreboard. 19-7 now. As we creep into the last minute of the second round, Jade Jones, the Flint fighter, well, she's on form now.
Jade's not really giving Kudashova anything to work with. She's keeping the pressure on. Still in the lead, but still doing what she needs to do to stay in the lead.
Well, the Copper Box Arena, the host to this one, semi-final number one. And Jade Jones is number one at the moment, bossing this contest. And Kudashova tries with her back leg. Headshot attempt from the Russian. She's not giving up without a fight, to her credit. But Jade Jones, again with that stab, changes it upstairs. Leaves a little gap in the clinch, but she'll learn from that one. Last 10 seconds of an excellent second round. And it's business as usual for Jade Jones. Tatiana Kudashova, well, she's going to have to go back and try and find a minor miracle here. Second round in favour of Jones, and a handsome margin.
Yeah, great round for Jones. She'll be happy with that. And again, very comfortable going into the last round. I don't really think her tactics will change or should change.
It doesn't need to change, and you don't need to adjust your eyes. Jones 19, Kudashova 7. Well, here we go, third round, potentially the final round, and there's Tatiana Kudashova. Can subdue this Partizan home crowd. The referee, well, we mentioned she's a former fighter, just checking the gum shields are in. Jones showed up without one in the first round, but she's certainly got her teeth into this fight here. 19-7, a handy lead. Kudashova looking a little bit confused and bemused here on the back foot, pushing upstairs. Good counter there from Kudashova. The Russian cuts it to a 10-point game. A decent start from the Russian. Back kick attempt from Jones, well blocked from Tatiana Kudashova. Still Jade Jones starting well. Sarah Stevenson, big punch there.
She's doing much better in that short distance. She's keeping away with Jones, has got that strong right leg, and she's got a great spin off the left leg, so she's using that to her advantage. She might get caught a little bit underneath, but other than that, she's in control, she's comfortable. A nice attempted headshot by Kudashova there. No point, but a little front leg twice for Jones there. Kudashova switching off, not covering the shots, and Jones taking advantage. And another attempted headshot by Jones, but unfortunately no score, but I think she'll be happy with that.
Yep, reasons to be cheerful to Jade Jones here. Thought about trying to cram that one up the stairs, but good blocking from Kudashova. She stayed in the contest to Russian, and the semi-finals go. A handsome lead for Jones. And she's into the last minute of this third round, and it's going to be the final round. Jade Jones in imperious form here. when she won the Olympic Games not too far from here in the Olympic Stadium in London. Can she go one better than the other? A little bit of hook upstairs there. Could have shown saw it, as did the ref. Gamjon to play, but it's very much Jones in the ascendancy.
It's a difficult situation, the really, really close distance there, so I can totally understand and feel how you can get your arms a little bit tangled, but she seems to be doing a lot better as the day is going on.
And time is certainly going on here for Kudashova. Lovely little shift in there from Jade Jones. Cuts the distance. Has a little fly look at the scoreboard as well. And it makes very good viewing indeed into the business end of this semi-final. Jones has a handsome 23-10 lead. Kudashova struggling, overreaching. And it's all over Bather shouting there. Good shot from Kudashova on the inside. The punch from Jones. And she's going to close the door on the ambitions of Kudashova. Another left-handed punch. Both hands in the air, it is Jade Jones into the final, deservedly so, and Sarah Stevenson from start to finish, kick perfect.
She was brilliant. It's really, really good to see Jade Jones back, and I mean that in every sense of the word. She's looking good, you know, she's looking confident. That win will be a nice boost up for her confidence. It's very, very difficult to find motivation after you've won another Olympic goal. So
we were discussing that earlier on at lunch. How do you, after you talk about the Olympic hangover as you see the confirmation there that Jones is into the final. You win it twice.
Yeah.
It must be hard to get up the next day and go to training.
It's very difficult. I think, obviously, she's never going to want to give away what she's won, and everyone wants what she's achieved, which is outstanding. But just to, you've won what your dream is twice, what everyone's dream is twice, so it's difficult to find that motivation, and she looks like she's there now.
She's got the motivation, she's into the final, and here's how she did it. Well, the hits just keep on coming. A classic win there for Jones. Who's going to face her in the final? Patricia Adamkiewicz will be hoping it will be the Polish fighter Ia Rum. Well, she'll have plenty to say about this one. Semi-final number two. It's just moments away. Well, the crowd enjoying this one, of course. Top class entertainment here in the Copper Box, where they've just seen Jade Jones bash her way past Kudashova into the final. Will it be Adamkiewicz or Ia Rum? No much room to manoeuvre as we move towards the business end of this competition. Semi-final number two, the female minus 57 grouping. And the youngsters greatly inspired. And of course, talking about youngsters, Sarah, you were recently out at the European Cadet Championships team manager. So important for these kids to get that experience up close and personal with the very best in the world.
It's amazing to see a lot of them here today as well, and really, they've been really, really inspired. They've been there themselves at the pinnacle of their sport, but to see them here now is just, it's just amazing.
And an amazing performance for Adamkiewicz. Bruna Valecic put up no competition at all in the quarter-final. And the pole, well, she was well ahead. Ia Rum comes into this one. Well, she would be the form favourite. Asian Games champion on a couple of occasions. World champion as well. And Rosie Delegarova, a nice wave there from the young volunteer. Well, Ia Rum, of course, from the Olympic University, Hangul Chedi. I'm sure you've spent many a happy afternoon in there, Sarah.
I wouldn't say happy. very, very inspiring university training. We went there so many times and, you know, learned so much.
and trying to put that knowledge into this one here, the semi-final Iharum. Well, is there room for her in the final of this one? Jade Jones awaits, and she did it in fine style. And also, it was a final, or a semi-final, Sarah, that Jade had to work enough that she'll be ready for the final. It wasn't a walkover.
No, I think she needed to up her level a little bit than what she has done today. Not that she hasn't been good today, just the fact that I think for herself, just to make her feel like, OK, now I'm back here, I'm home, it's where I belong. So that, for her, the way she fought there was... You're just seeing Jade back. It was just nice to see. So she's going to be really, really motivated for the final now. So whoever wins this match needs to get ready for Jade, because she's back.
Well, she's back and she means business. And she's got a little bit of unfinished business with Iharum before. The Korean, a top-class fighter, Angela Gay de Oliveira from the USA. Big moments for her. She runs the rule over this second semi-final in the under 57 kilogram grouping Grand Prix, day number two. Korean coach, double world champion in the corner, handy to have that advice. And here we go, down to business, 3 times 2 minute rounds. Adamkiewicz, the taller of the two, but not by much. Iharum, known for her footwork and her relaxed style. Into the open stance, straight away. The Poland blue, the Korean in red. And Iharum trying to flick forward. Adamkiewicz very comfortable on the back foot, good on the defensive, and lands a little push kick of her own to start.
I think it was more like a counter chop kick to the stomach, so that was very unique. I like that, that was good.
Perfect precision from the pole. Dropped it down and puts herself into the lead. Iharum now has to come forward, punch from a bit far away, a bit of a haymaker, but it scores. And the copper box was the venue for the boxing at the Olympic Games in London. And that punch landed cleanly.
You can just see the difference of experience and strength a little bit so far. Iharum just kind of having the edge, a bit more athletic. Doesn't mean that she's going to have the better outcome, but the difference there is quite clear.
No,
so
I think
far.
You're right in that relaxed movement. Well, we talked about the Olympic University for a reason, training 3 times a day, and it's evident there. Kicks and then counters, scores and then keeps it going. So that muscle memory, that constant repetition, plus to make it into the national team of Korea, no disrespect to Poland, it is harder to make it into that team. So she's got that sparring experience as well.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of pressure on them as well. You know, they make it through this far, so for them, they want to make it through either more, you know, and come out on top. But she's definitely showing her athleticism against Adamkiewicz here.
As you said, that athleticism matched by the technique into the last 30 of the first round there. Nice little chop kick. Well, you mentioned it, Sarah, before. Hasn't quite got a range yet, but Adamkiewicz still in this contest. As we creep towards the end of the first round. Close with the headshot there, Iharum. But it's a nice little shot to the body that scores. And the Korean in control as we creep towards the end of the first round. Decent from Adamkiewicz in terms of the start. But Iharum showed that quality, Sarah.
Yeah, Iharum there was, for me, the better, you know, more consistent player in that round. Really liking that short distance, so if she does win this, I think Jade needs to have just to focus a little bit more in that clinch, as we would say, in the short distance. But, you know, Adamkiewicz, I'm sure she's got something else in the bag, so she's going to have some chats now with the coach and change her tactics a little bit.
Some running repairs from the doctor in the corner for Korea. A little bit of stretching. Trying to stretch her lead will be Iharum. Patricia Adamkiewicz very much in this. Well, she came 9th at the World Championships, did the pole. She's not poles apart so far against Iharum. Now here we go, round number two. All to play for here. Into the open stance, as was customary. In the previous round, Adamkiewicz searching. Iharum eyeballing her, tries a little hook round the corner.
Adamkiewicz there, very strong with that chop kick. just needs to reach in a little bit more, put her body weight forward a little bit.
Yep, as you rightly say, the head is back, the distance is just a little bit off. Needs to get the confidence up here, the pole, but hard to come by. Yarum forcing her way forward. Doesn't need to score, just needs to keep the clock ticking. 4 point gap.
Yarum, for me, very good at finding the gap, finding the distance. Got caught there from Adamkiewicz, headshot.
But still ahead, Yarum, by the merest of margins as we creep towards the halfway point of the second round. The Korean still has the dominance, extends it further there. Nice little shot to the body and another for good measure. And she's certainly got the measure of Adamkiewicz here. Good shot from the pole in response. A real fight happening here.
For me, Yarum very good at disguising which way she's going to go. She's going to go one way, fake to the other way again there. Unfortunately didn't score there, but exactly what I mean. Trying to go one way, fake the other, and picking up a few points there. Always having the edge.
Well, on the edge of defeat is Adamkiewicz, halfway through this one. The pole has to try and give Yarum something to think about. Nice footwork forward, good little counter there, but flooring the pole there. Yarum lands it cleanly, and that one will help. I think we're going to see a video replay from the Polish coach. Let's have a little look here. Former European champion, the pole in the corner. 10 point gap. Will this make a difference?
Yarum, I think for me, is very comfortable there. She's got some really, really clean shots, which is really nice to see. And she's finding it really quite easy to score to the body.
Yeah, pretty much a mirror image of the previous. Jade Jones had a relative procession through to the final. And it's the same for Yarum. Well, let's have a look at the point of contestation here. Well, maybe the Polish coach asking for a push there.
Push while kicking is probably the only thing he can try to say.
Probably won't make too big a difference in terms of the outcome of this match. It will only deny what seems to be the inevitable. Yarum has a very useful 10-point cushion. There's still some time in this. 10 times now. Far from a game changer because of the margin. But the Polish coach, we've had confirmation there, asking for the Gamjon to be invalidated for pushing. So more than hope than expectation here. And there is confirmation overruled. Chris Cordling there helping out on the video replay panel. And to the last 15 seconds or so of this second round, Yarum tries a little flick round the corner.
Great movement there by Yarum. She was a little bit upset that she didn't score after, but still, she's still keeping in control, still keeping that good distance.
And she's winning by a distance as we go to the end of the second. Yarum very much in second gear here, taking her time and looking pretty confident, Sarah.
Yeah, you can see that she has another level, but I think she's saving it for Jade, and rightly so, because she's going to need it, because Jade, you know, again, she was on fire. So if Yarum is the one to make it through, then we're in for a good match.
Well, the alleged push on the pole made no difference to the scoreboard. The video replay card gone for Team Poland. And Yarum, well, she looks pretty calm and cool here. And Sarah Stevenson was advising us maybe saving a little bit for the final, but of course, full concentration required. Adamkiewicz coming into this one. A Youth Olympic Games bronze medalist. Making a big step up now to the top tier. Can she go one better here? She's going to need 10 points to get back into this one. Yarum, very adept at covering into that open stance. Nice little hook round the corner, Sarah.
Yeah, that was really nice. A nice hook, nice point, good movement out of the distance. Being safe.
Well, she was safe, but the pole was sorry. 19-7, just missing with that one as well. The confidence high, likewise the legs. Nice step through back kick there, old school, straight out of the Olympic University. And she graduated with honours with that one. Didn't score though. But Adamkovic, well, she felt that one.
I think Lee Arun, for me, is trying out some new techniques. This is a great opportunity to try. You know, can she do something different? Does she need to use it for Jade? Okay, I'll try it in this match. And, you know, that's the best time to do it. When you're comfortable and have a lead like this, then, yeah, why not try something new?
As you see, trying new techniques, but nothing new on the scoreboard. It's as we were, as Iarum sails into the sunset here. A minute or so to go in the third. Well, the Korean coach saying watch out for that front leg, keeping the confidence and concentration, as you say there, Sarah, just trying to play a little bit here.
Yeah, just trying to switch it, change legs, try to spin. You know, for me, almost giving, because they're going to be watching this. Jade's coach is going to probably be watching this, maybe even Jade. So, you know, she can spin. She can. She has good movement. She has good avoidance. She has good cover. And she's good in the short distance. So they're the things to look out for the final.
And the voice there of Sarah Stevenson, Great Britain's first ever world champion, Olympic medalist as well. Giving the insight there. But finding the inside room is Iarum. 29-10. She's just running down the clock, step through, reverse turning kick. That's really interesting what you say, Sarah, sending a message to the opponent in the final.
Yeah, potentially, either that or, again, just trying out something new, but inadvertently does send a message because it's just showing you right at the end, OK, we didn't realise you had this, so let's just watch out for that.
Well, the only thing that matters now is the clock is ticking and the ambitions of Adamkiewicz, well... She did her best to pull, but by a distance, Iarum the winner. She advances to the final. And if you don't know, well, it will be against Jo Jones, and she will be going for it in the Grand Prix final. A repeat of the World Championships in Muju, where Iarum defeated Jade Jones. Can she repeat the feat, or will it be revenge for the British fighter? Confirmation there, Iarum into the final. And of course, Sarah, once you find out this is your opponent, are they straight into strategies?
I think so. They've not really got much time to waste, really. You know, they're going to be watching it. They're going to be thinking, OK, what's our tactics going to be? And then get straight onto it mentally.
Had the best of the female fighters in the under 57. Time for the men now. 1 kilo up, and who's going to have points up? Thailand, Iran, Spain, and Russia. It's Hamprap and Hajipur, Tortosa, and Artominov. They're up for your entertainment. Thailand against Iran, up first. Well, Iran and Thailand have plenty of previous. They're reigning the victor in the Universiad. Can Hamprap take the win this time? Well, who's going to shine brightest in this one? Second in Rio, standing on the top of the podium. Will he manage it this time? Fifth at the World Championships, just 19 years old, the fighter from Bangkok, top class fighter. Rene Marshall marching him in as well, and that's his route through. The big win against Carlos Navarro, world number one. Ohadipur Selemani from Iran. Wonderful moments for Abigail Low, Ireland as well. And that win against Jack Woolley. Credit to the young Irishman. Had a great day here at the Grand Prix. But Armin Hadipur, the top man for a reason. world military silver medalist, the man from Tehran. And in July of this year, they fought in the Universiad, which is kind of like an Olympic Games style multi-sport for university students. And it was 10-8 in favour of the Iranian. And Sarah, of course, you've fought against people where you've beat them and you've lost to them before. Does it affect your plan for the next time?
Yeah, it should do, because obviously if you haven't beat them, then you've got your tactics wrong.
I think that was probably the stupidest question I've ever asked of all time there.
Yeah, well, maybe you should have said something about, you know, being maybe having a bit of a mental... You could have a little bit of a worry, you know, could it happen again? It could maybe affect your mental strength and confidence a little bit, but certainly if you lost, then you need to, you know, change it.
Yep, you need some modifications. And Tawan Hamprat, well, he's shown his quality. He's a bit of an underdog on the way through in the Olympic Games. Made it to that final. Top class fighter as well. Asian Games champion, which is no mean feat against the flying feet of the Korean fighters. Iran and China, of course, as well. And it is the Iranian here. Well, his rate through to this semi-final. Looked in good form. I was just mentioning there, Sarah, the win against Jack Woolley. Young Irishman, a good day at the office.
He had a great day. I was watching his last 16 match as well, and, you know, 20-point gap, you know, over these world-class players. He was very inspiring. The crowd were loving it. You know, it would have been great for him to make it here, and I think, you know, but he has had a fantastic day.
Yeah, he's had a taste of the big time, but both men trying to go forward to their final. They've been in this territory before. They know each other well. Sairo Sato, the Japanese official, will go through the customary checking of the body protectors. Final thoughts from Hamprat. Ready to rumble here. The first of the semi-finals in the men's under 58 kilogram grouping. Straight into the open stance. Straight out with the push kick is Hamprat. Trying to work around. Nice footwork from the Thai fighter. Just sliding round the corner. A little bit of a block there as well from the Thai fighter. He's the man in blue. And we know the flexibility of Hajipur. No matter how close he is, he can kick to the head. Has that quality. But both men just checking out the distance there. Hamprat trying to sneak round the corner.
Both showing off as well a lot of strength, which is good to see for the lighter weights. You can hear the power. You can see the good footwork, the good movement and the strength that they have as well.
As you say, they've got ridiculous strength for the weight that they are. They pack that power. And Hajipur just faking back there to Hamprat. Both men just giving each other the eyeball, trying to a bit of kidology. Headshot attempt from both. Hamprat getting close. A minute and some change left in this one.
Great focus for me from Hajipur. You can really see it in his eyes and his face. He's really wanting to control that distance. And a gamjung there for Hamprat.
Yeah, I think he tried to control that a little bit too much there. As you see, Hajipur putting on the pressure and the gamjung helping him out. So one gamjung separating them. 40 to go. A nice punch on the inside there from Hamprat, getting closer with a little left leg turning kick as well. The Bangkok brawler getting a little bit closer. Hajipur comes forward again, gives him something to think about.
Really showing off his strength now, Hajipur. You know, he's trying everything to try and control the match. But again, still quite even. Still anything can happen, but he's really showing his strength off and, you know, trying to dominate this match.
And he is dominating in terms of intensity. Not too much on the scoreboard, but you can see Hamprat backing away here. Hajipur has won the battle for the centre ground and takes a very slender 1-0 lead. Man, Hajipur hasn't really got it going yet. Tawan Hamprat, we know he's got all the spinning techniques. He's got a good back kick. Hasn't unleashed it as yet, though. Well, the national team of Iran, you mentioned it, Sarah, that intensity and that short distance. they eyeball you, they look at you, they're not afraid of any sort of confrontation.
Yeah, very common from the Iranian athletes. That's where they're most comfortable, very renowned for that. And they, you know, they still win a hell of a lot as well.
Yeah, one of the preeminent nations. They actually became the top male nation over Korea in 2015. So a changing of the guard. Korea invented it, Iran have mastered it. But can Thailand spoil the party here?
I think Hamprad, for me, was quite happy to let Hajipour kind of control the ring a little bit there. For me, I think he was waiting for something, waiting to see what he's going to do. Can he unleash his spinning techniques in this round? The roles have reversed.
Yep, no question about it. The wise words from Sarah Stevenson, our expert analysis provided. I'm trying to take that advice and come forward here as Hamprad. A bit more intensity from the Thai fighter. He's certainly not intimidated. And you can make it to the Olympic final. You know your way around. But Hajipour, intense, up close. But it is indeed the open stance that's preventing them. They're giving that shoulder, trying to invite their opponent in with the back leg, but no man taking the bait just yet.
Hamprad just telling the referee that he wants to adjust his shin guard there.
He's going to have to be on guard here. Hajipour steady on his feet, not giving away any distance. Good front leg there, lands clean.
Yeah, great shot from Hajipour there, but a nice cut underneath.
As we cut into the end of this second round, into the last minute here, Tamin Hamprad tries to go with a punch, almost eats a headshot on the way through there. And the intensity from the Iranian evident. Nice little shot underneath as well. Good reaction off the spot, Sarah.
Yeah, great shot there. Faking with the check, getting the distance, seeing a gap, taking the shot and scoring the point.
And as you see, talk a little bit of the concentration needed for that. First one didn't work, second phase.
You've just got to be ready all the time because there could be an opportunity at any moment. It is literally a split second game. And you've got to be ready to take the advantage. To focus for three rounds is very, very difficult, but that's what's going to make you the winner.
As you say, split second decisions. And the seconds are ebbing away here. Into the last 10. Good long distance punch there from Hamprad. Walks into a shot from Hajipour. He saw it coming and he's extended it to a 5-0 lead. Very useful from the Iranian.
I think Hamprad there was trying the punch there. For me, his technique's not the best. It's too far exactly. He's too far away. John just showed me the movement there of how far he was.
A little bit of dancing in the commentary box. Well, that's the difference in terms of the highlights in that one. Hajipour has a really useful 5-point lead here. If you're Hamprad in the other corner, we know he's got those spinning techniques. Is it time to let them out the bag?
I think so. I think it's necessary now. And I mean, I wouldn't leave it too long as well, because it is five points behind. You know, but one spin shot can start to close the gap a little bit. So I think he needs to start bringing it out as soon as possible and take a risk. You have to. You know, you're 5 points down, you've got to try something different, because Hajipour has the advantage of kind of keeping control, creating opportunities. So Hamprad has to mix it up a little bit now and give him something to think about.
Well, lots to think about for him here as we get into the business end of this one. The third and potentially final round. Hajipour would hope so. Hamprad not. He's trying to pull himself back into this one. Kicking low there. Trying to pull a Gamjon. And he's managed it. Nice tactics there. Hajipour not too happy with that one. But Hamprad is on the board. As you mentioned, Sarah, the spinning techniques would pull him back into this one nicely. But he's going to have to get in the head a little bit now of Hajipour, who's not been in a fight here. Been a procession so far from the man in red. Tries again with a flick to the body.
I think Hamprad needs to kick, not be celebrating his kick. Let's just go back, go with the back leg, and let's try and kick again. It's another way of recovery.
Yep, he needs to get the kicks going in some flurries here. give Hajipur more to think about. Tense times now for the Thai fighter. 4-point gap. Headshot just misses. And Hajipur, so good in that distance there. Always intimidating. And almost scoring again. Controls the mat nicely. Keeps his foot in. Slips out though. And it is going to be the Gamjon.
Forcing the Gamjon. There's another way, you know, to try and creep back the points. So good to see that Hampav's switching the pressure back. Trying to take control of the match. Trying to force too many Gamjungs there. Maybe get him a little Oscar as well.
The best actor award. Grabs the leg as well there. Can he grab some sort of shot to the body there? Tries with a big back leg turning kick. Hajipur off balance. Still covers well. Into the last 45 seconds. There's the back kick for the first time from the Thai fighter. He knows the headshots are there for the Iranian. Tries it again. A bit low with it perhaps.
I think for me, Hajipur is surviving a little bit, and I'd be worried for him. You can't just survive. There's a reason why I've got 5 points.
Yep, and there
6 points now.
Yep, exactly. Well, the reason it went from 5 to 6, as you say, Sarah, the Gamjon, and that has been protested by Chae Yong-suk, the coach from Thailand. And this could be important here. We haven't seen the best of Hamprap in terms of an attacking force. They were out at the US Open in Vegas just a few weeks ago, so perhaps some tiredness in the legs. And there is Chae Yong-suk, highly experienced coach by way of Pungseng High School and the Olympic University. Knows his way around. Very successful Thai team, even from back in your era, Sarah, 2004 onwards.
I think they took a little bit of a dip, and you know, it's good to see. You know, I've had a bit of a break and I've come back, you know, and they're back up there again. So Thailand are back on up and coming, which is great to see. Well, not up and coming, they're back.
Yeah, absolutely, back in business. And as you mentioned, Jade Jones back in business as well. She's in the final. Both men trying to repeat that feat, but it was a low kick to the shin. Chae Yong-suk looking pensive. Likewise, Tawin Hamprap. Palpable tension here in the copper box. A game-changing moment in the offing here. At the moment, it stands at 6-2. Renata Rekovic from Croatia says, no deal, the card is gone, and are the hopes of Hamprap going with it? 4-point gap.
He's trying hard to get these points back. Now he's mixing it up, now he's spinning, now he's using combination kicks. That was a fabulous D-point headshot there from Hamprap.
Well, coming on like a house on fire. Yeah, as you say, Sarah.
I think the Gamjon for himself there for pushing, but referee's deemed that nobody deserves a Gamjon.
Yeah, referee let it slide, but the corner judge noticed that there was some sort of infringement. The centre referee telling the coach to have a seat, and we're back in business here. Last 15 seconds in a pulsating round here. Tawin Hamprap scores a shot under the guard. Hajipur tries to punch and step forward. A bit of grabbing on the inside. Is it going to be the Gamjon? Into the last 10 seconds now. Tawin Hamprap was points down. Hajipur has responded. 7 apiece. Well, we said Hajipur didn't want the golden point round. Hamprap most certainly did. Can he see his way through there? He most certainly can. Talk about tenacity, Sarah Stevenson.
Yeah, he deserved to pull that match back. For me, you know, Hajipur, he survived too much there. And they're like, I don't understand why you're controlling two and a half rounds, and then you go back, and now you're in sudden death. It's everything we tell our junior squad, our cadet squad, not to do. So there's a prime example when it really, really matters.
Well, the coaching masterclass delivered by Sarah Stevenson. Exactly right. Hajipur on the back foot. Defended too quickly. And Tawin Hamprap, well, he fairly pounced. And produced a wonderful flurry. Now, this one, toss of a coin time. Whoever scores the first point, they are going into the Grand Prix final here in London. Chae Yong-suk, the Thai coach, is advising, keep the guard tight, keep the elbows in. Contrasting calm coach from Iran in the corner. Well, the intensity builds.
Interesting to see who's going to try and take control of this round.
And as you rightly say, yeah, we will. And it's a 1 minute round, an adaptation in the rules. The golden point conducted over the reduced period. And if it doesn't score on the protectors, which I have a feeling it will, it will see who kicks the body protector the most. Hamprap, he's in blue, and it's straight away there. Hajipur straight out the blocks, into the body. And that's what it means to the Iranians there. Got it done in the end, Sarah.
Straight from the off, straight away. You know, for me, golden point round, it can be anyone's game. You know, they're both trying to come out fighting a little bit, but Hadjipourdis had the edge there, took the shot, found the gap, straight into the final.
Golden score, but will it be the gold medal? Armin Hadjipour Cheleghani, top class performance from him. Started off in ferocious form. Nice to see national team coaches sharing the joy of their fighter. Well, he's a charming young man off the mat. Ferocious fighter on it. Gets it done in the end. Going for gold will be Hadjipour from Iran. And going against him will be one of these men here, Jesus Tortosa Cabrera or Mikhail Artamonov. Well, Cabrera. Bronze at the Youth Olympic Games back in the day. He's fairly made a big step up here. Took a bronze in the Senior Worlds. Big moments for Olivia Lowe Ireland as well. Nice wave. But will it be hands in the air at the end for Cabrera? Strong win against Thailand. Sawit Wiri, one of the favourites. Well, the man from Moscow, Mikhail Artamonov, flanked by... Well, what should be a top-class match against Jesus Tortosa. Lost by a point in the World Championship final this year. Very strong scoring earlier in the day. And that win against Morocco, a tough one. Followed by a top-class win against the Iranian Asian Games champion. So here we go, it is the second semi-final. Jesus Tortosa Cabrera against Mikhail Artamonov.
I'm loving Artamonov's body language, you know, shoulders back, head up. I like that. Even if you don't believe it, it can make you feel confident.
That's really important to know, because projecting that confidence, showing that you mean business,
yeah.
You walk out, you own the mat. And as you say, body language so important. His shoulders are back, well, his hands be in the air at the end of this one. One thing's for sure, his feet will be. Artamonov, an expansive kicker, loves to kick up and down the way, drag it down the body armour. And Jesus Tortosa Cabrera, good at covering. Can he cover himself in glory here? Che Yongbae, centre referee. I've been really pleased so far. No malfunctions in terms of the electronic protectors. It's all worked smooth.
So far, so good. It's always a bonus.
Exactly. Lets it flow freely. Jesus Tortosa Cabrera, a big Kia there, which means to shout. And is he in with a shout in this one? closed stands from both men. A little bit of a departure. Old school style, trying to skip forward there. Nice fake there from Artamonov. Gets a little bit of ground on it. Gives Tortosa something to think about.
Very calm and composed from this match. Completely different to the first match where you tried to see kind of them both outpowering each other. Seem to be a little bit more relaxed, a little bit more wary of each other.
Well, Tortosa Cabrera just a little bit off with the distance there. Trying to reach back, as you see, that composure from Artamonov, eyeballing his opponent. And it is 0-0 all across the board. No pressure. Turning into points. A little hook around the back there. The distance getting closer from Tortosa. And the leg guard just coming loose there from the Russian. But he's okay to continue. Into the last minute here. It's been a slow and steady start to this first round.
Tortosa, for me, is trying to find a second action, third action. He's taken a risk without actually committing to the shot so far. It's not a bad way to start the first round.
Yep, gathering intel but not gathering points, as you say, not a bad approach as we approach the last 30 seconds. Good counter there from Artamonov.
Good cover from Tortosa, making it difficult.
Both men cancelling each other out here. Down the stretch. Stretching up with the headshot, Tortosa Cabrera goes for it again there. A fair distance away though, into the last 10 seconds. Artamonov working to hold the centre ground. It is Tortosa Cabrera. Both men deciding enough's enough. High five, low scores. Or no scores, in fact.
No scores, yeah. Still just trying to figure each other out. Not really, again, neither one willing to commit to any shots. If we commit, we're at risk of getting countered, so... Yeah, they need to just kind of step up a little bit in the next round, see what happens. But not a bad first round.
Yep, of course, you've got to gather the information, figure out what's needed to be done. It didn't come out at the ridiculous fast pace that Jay Jones is known for, and Bianca Walton, who's coming up later on. Slow and steady wins the race. A marathon, not a sprint in terms of this one. And Tortosa Cabrera, known for his patience. And as you pointed out as well, Sarah, known for his ability to cover, very good at that.
Yeah, I think the Spanish team overall, and the Russian team as well, renowned for good for having good cover. So you can maybe look at a player and think they're not maybe technically or tactically great, but is having good cover a part of that? I believe it is. I believe it's something that you should learn right from the off if you wanted to do sport fighting.
No question about it. And right from the off, kick, cover and recover. And both men trying to do just that. Good shot there from Artamonov. Flicks it round the corner. As you see the distance between the two, both men leaning back, keeping themselves well out of the distance because they've got that headshot capacity.
Yeah, again, neither one willing to fully commit to their shots, which would mean having to move your head forward, again at risk. Tortosa, for me, pushing a little bit more than he did in the first round, trying to kind of force his opponent back, trying to create something to happen. Again, good cover, that body shot did not phase Tortosa one bit.
As you say, not phased. And nothing moving on the scoreboard, both men cancelling each other out. A tale of quality, they also know each other from previous competition. Tortosa the victor in that one. Artamonov, well, you can see the overhead shot there, the distance between the two minimal. And the score non-existent. Of course, the mats in taekwondo about 1 meter in length, so trying to keep a mat between your opponent, that usually gives way during the rounds, you get closer and closer. But nothing doing on the scoreboard. Last 45 of the second.
Either player for me in this stance here, seeing the closed stance, it's easier to spin, to react to your opponent, and it's a bit of a safe shot in some cases, so I'd quite like to see one of them attempt a spin, possibly.
No, I think it's a good tactic. Safety first has certainly been the order of the day in that close distance. We know that Artamonov has a good reverse turning kick on the back leg, but this could also be... Well, a gam-jom game as well. One would be useful, causes your opponent to come forward. But it's a real stalemate here into the last 10 seconds. Well, no risk, no reward. No points on the board. And it's the early handshake from both there. Not happy with that one, Sarah.
I don't think our Tomilov was happy with that. I mean, I wouldn't be. 4 seconds to go and you're trying to shake my hand. I don't really get what he's trying to do. I don't think that's right. I think maybe 1-2 seconds max. But when it's 0-0...
Yeah, I'm agreeing with you. I was looking at it as well, thinking that's just a time-wasting tactic. Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't... Our Tomilov did the right thing, you know. Very sportsmanlike there by actually agreeing to shake his hand. But I think he's a little bit taken aback.
It says plenty when that is the highlight of the round. The debate over the handshake. Handshake gate.
Handshake gate, yeah. I think, so confused that one. But anyway, let's move on. Yep. What we're going to do next. Please someone do a spin or do something to get some points on the board.
I think the Spanish coach saying just that, Sarah, trying to get his charge to get a wriggle on here. We're into the third and final round. Well, we see the final round. This one's got golden score written on it if they come back out in that same defensive posture. But a Gamjon game could be possible. Trying to force your opponent back here. And it is the Russian Artomonov doing that. But good response from Tortosa Cabrera.
Not enough pressure, though, for me, John. I think we need a little bit more. If you're going to try and force Gamjon, then you need to give your opponent something to worry about. There's a little bit more intent there from Artomonov, but not enough to push him out the ring.
As we push forward into, well, giving you a time check when there's a minute and a half left, that usually is a sign that there's not much action going on. You can see for yourself. So let's just have a little look at this one. Headshot missing there from Tortosa. When your distance is still off in the third round, that means you're not going for it.
Exactly. They're both still waiting for something. You know, quite clearly they have their tactics. But for me, you need to pull something out of the bag. You need to give them something to think about, whether that's just second, third action. But they're doing it, but not with enough intent.
Well, a minute left in the third round, and the match hasn't started yet. So if you've just tuned in, you've missed absolutely nothing. Both men cancelling each other out. Tortosa Cabrera has a little look at the scoreboard. And we're into the business end now. Who can find the shot? Both men have stayed in that close stance all the way through here. Tomanov shifting back. We mentioned the cover. Well, you called it correct, Sarah. Both Spain and Russia good at blocking, and they're blocking the attempts here. Headshot missing by a fine margin there. Backline turning kick from Tortosa Cabrera. Breaks with protocol. Actually does some taekwondo. I spy with my little eye, something beginning with taekwondo, the back leg missing, the golden point in the offing, the headshot over the shoulder. I don't know if someone told them that the match had started yet.
I mean, Tortosa then, he tried a little bit there to try the crescent kick in the clinch, but I think Artomonov was ready for it. He was waiting, he was leaning back. There wasn't enough intent from Tortosa. I don't know what they're going to do in something there, because nothing's happened in the three rounds to make anything happen. No Gamjungs, no points. Yep. Very difficult.
No question, Sarah. No points and no indication. The only thing that is sure, there'll be plenty fresh because they saved their legs for all 6 minutes. And in this one final minute here, who's going to go for it? One punch would do it. We've seen nothing of the attacking threat, but we know, if you were joining us yesterday, and Bradley Sindon fell foul of Ahmad Abagosh in sudden death. So only takes one good shot, get your tactics right, and it could be all over. A spot in the final. Armin Hadzipour Seligani of Iran is waiting for them. The referee makes his way to the centre. If you're just tuning in, you've missed nothing. Both men into the golden point now. It is two Gamjons required. As Artomonov tries a little flick to the body.
Nothing much different than the first two rounds.
Tortosa Cabrera trying to push, trying to block, back leg turning kick. Well, we saw the cover excellent of both cover. Men. Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, both players, excellent cover again. So difficult to score on each other.
Well, Artomonov thought he had scored there, has a look round the corner. Of course, if it doesn't score, that one does though on the inside. Well, the punch, perhaps given out of sympathy there. I didn't see too much steam on that one. But steaming into the final to go against Armin Hadzipour of Iran is the man from Russia. Nothing to report in terms of highlights, but it is the man from Moscow who marches on.
I think Armatov is going to have to work a little bit harder in the final against his Iranian competitor.
Well, not much power on the punch, but it was enough to land him a spot in the final. Confirmation there by Golden Point. Tartosa Cabrera is out. Mikhail Artamonov is into the final. Well, top-class entertainment here in the Copper Box, and it's just about to build to a crescendo here. The next matchup, Great Britain against Mexico. And the knowledgeable local crowd here, they've been treated to a real good competition. Apart from that last match, a bit of a stalemate, so we'll move on. Lots to look forward to this one, Sarah. Bianca Walden against Acosta Braceda. A classic in the making, hopefully.
Yeah, they've had a few battles in the past, so... Yeah, we'll see. We've had a few matches. I think the big one for Bianca was when Acosta beat her in the World Championships in 2011, which I think hurt Bianca, but she's come back and she's beat her since, so a little bit of rivalry there.
Well, speaking of rivals, Walden and Acosta, they will be up first. Well, the crowd loving this one, as is Abigail Green. A special coach relationship.
Yeah, Paul Green being her dad.
And who will be in charge of this one? Double European champion, double world champion, Olympic bronze medalist as well. Bianca Walden, the home favourite, trying to upset the apple cart. Acosta Braceda. The Mexican marvel, Reni Marshall, walking her out. A youth Olympic silver medalist, topped it off with a senior world silver back in 2013 in Puebla. A couple of close fought matches for Acosta. Well, they've shared the ring so far. And Bianca Walden, as we have seen, Sarah, has started steadily and slowly built up as the day's gone on.
Yeah, she will. Sometimes, you know, some people can just give you a little bit of a tough fight. If they're not willing to give you anything to work with, and Bianca obviously thrives when people want to fight, that's when she comes out on top. So I think Acosta... we'll give her a little bit more of a fight and we'll see a better Bianca coming into this one. It's always difficult, John, when someone's not willing to fight you. You know, it can kind of just bring you down to their level a little bit and you get a little bit frustrated. And I think Bianca's a little bit frustrated in the last match, but she would have had a word with herself. She'd be ready for this one.
Well, like a true champion, turns that frustration into victory, finds a way to win. Can she find her form here against Acosta? They've shared the mat before, as you said, Sarah. Walton, the winner, eventually. But of course, the Mexican team, no slouches. Paul Green, big moments for the coach. Great win yesterday as Emuela Perpueta Ané from Côte d'Ivoire. So fresh from the win of Williams, can Walton repeat the feat here? She's won the last couple of Grand Prix. Won the Worlds, one in Moscow, one in Rabat, Morocco. Can she win here in her home Grand Prix in London, in the Copper Box? Acosta in red, Walton in blue, straight away with a push kick. Welcome to the match for Bredis Acosta. And it is that back leg from Walton this time. She changes stance, shuffling round. And she's become so good at dominating the centre of the mat. Big punch there from Acosta. Lands cleanly. Headshot from Lofton over the shoulder. And it is a great start there.
Yeah, nice headshot there from Bianca. Take the punch and then come back with a headshot.
Well, Walton happy to dominate the centre of the mat. Hook kick round the corner. Acosta glances worriedly at the scoreboard. It's as we were though. Walton stalking. Acosta trying to fake, trying to get some sort of reaction out of the world champion. It's another hook kick round the corner. Good start from Bianca Walton.
She's very good at this hook kick, but then trying to avoid really, really well after. It's a great technique.
Great technique and a great start. Back leg turning kick to boot there. That's a sign of confidence there from Walton. Lovely big jab through. Gives the Mexican lots of trouble. Well, you can just about hear Paul Green's instructions there.
I was just about to say, Acosta there was wide open in the body there to in the short distance. And obviously, Bianca's coach, Paul Green, picked that up as well. Obviously before me, I'm sure.
But picking up the pace here. Acosta trying to get back into this one. Bianca Walton pushes forward, lands nicely. These are not scoring shots, but they are sapping the energy of the Mexican, who does her best to get back into the centre.
Yeah, Bianca's just keeping her away there, making it really, really difficult for Acosta to get back in the game. But Acosta's going to have to move, or she's going to get a headshot, just as she did there. Bianca took advantage. Acosta wasn't moving as much, enough, and if you stay still too much, you get kicked in the head.
She most certainly did, Sarah. And there's a little bit of a conversation here. Paul Green asking for a video replay. The headshot landed clean. I think there was a kick after that, perhaps. Did you have a chance to see what was going on there?
He's quite clearly asking for the gambrel to be taken off.
Well, that's the advice. Give us some analysis of that, Sarah.
You're just getting Bianca to keep working, to keep wearing her down and not giving her a chance to do anything, really. Just staying on top of her, keeping away with a check, and then Bianca will take advantage when there's an opportunity. And the card was rejected, so the score will stay at 6-2 to Bianca Walton.
So it's as we were, 4-point gap into the end of this round here. Acosta has been a live threat in this one, tries a little skip there. And Bianca Walton's concentration pays off. 6-2 to the good. And Walton through the gate. And can she get through to the final?
All Bianca needs to do now, keep her away, using that stab. Don't let her in the game. And then just take advantage when you see an opportunity. First action stab, second action high. Just the only time is when she shifts out the distance.
That was the infringement of Gamjon just circling out into the red. Well, we called it, Sarah. The stab is the order of the day because they know that Acosta has to come forward now.
Acosta has good movement. She can use the ring. She has to. She's always been the smaller of the athletes in heavyweight, so don't really understand why she's not moving as much. She's making it easy for Bianca.
As you say, making it easier for her, just circling around, not really dominating it. Bianca Walton takes her customary position. Well, you spoke before about body language. Dominating the centre is Walton, refusing to give any distance to the shorter Acosta. And it's that stab to the body that both coach and fighter agreed upon as a tactic. And to execute your tactic in a big occasion, it shows you how far Bianca has evolved.
She has, yeah. The focus now of Bianca, she knows how to control a match. She knows who she is. She knows what she's good at. And she's sticking to it. Again,
sticks the headshot
there.
Perfect.
For Bianca in the short distance.
And again, John, for holding in the execution of that headshot. But it's a 6-point gap. A Costa. Well, she's up against it now. Tries to go with the front leg, and Walton shows that great ability to circle there. She's got excellent footwork for a taller fighter. And they'll have worked on that clinch on the inside there.
Yeah, Bianca Hyde in that little hold there that she did. But the referees can't see everything. But I think both athletes have been guilty of holding a little bit throughout this match so far. Nothing massively clear, though.
No, I think you're right. There's a little bit of confusion as to whether that point should have gone up. The Gamjon was signalled, but did it go up against the wrong fighter? That is the discussion at the moment. So that's certainly what Bianca is trying to do, a bit of refereeing on the side here. Yes, it is indeed. The Gamjon went up, the referee acknowledging that. In the heat of the moment, mistakes happen. But make no mistake about it, Walton in the ascendancy here. Last minute of the second.
Acosta needs to work, you know, as she, when she does attack, she does give Bianca something to think about. When she stands still too long, that's where the 9 points have come from. So she's doing much better, trying to stay in the match, trying to make something happen and attacking Bianca there, getting into that short distance.
Well, Acosta as attacking force has been subdued. Walton with that big back leg turning kick. She loves the front leg. She's letting the back kick out as well now.
Yeah, she can mix it up a little bit now, Bianca. She's adding so much more skills to her game. But the biggest one that she's got is her confidence. She knows that she's world, she's double world champion. And that she brings that into every single match now.
Trying to bring herself back into this match. Acosta with that Gamjon. Reduced to five as we go into the dying seconds of this semi-final here. Good back kick attempt from the Mexican. Left her head hanging. And Walton chases her around the mat and will fall foul of the referee for a Gamjon, much to the consternation of the passionate home crowd. We'll get a chance to discuss that in a second there. Not a big fan of that decision, and Walton, well, the victim of her own downfall. Acosta has 5 points and four of them have come from Walton.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, of course, back to get a little bit of a breather here. It's been a good start from Walton.
Yeah,
perhaps a little
there.
Anxious.
A little bit maybe in the second half of that round. I think Acosta knew she had to do something. So she came back, started moving a little bit, started attacking more, giving Bianca something to think about, forcing the Gamjungs. Still not really scoring herself. Not managed to score actually with her own techniques. But a point's a point.
As soon as she comes inside, change your position, go to the face. If you don't work back to the body, then get out or just escape. Okay?
Fantastic coaching there from Paul Green, Sarah Stevenson. As you called it, the clinch is the danger one. Grabbing on the arm on the inside there.
Again, it's difficult. Acosta's obviously smaller than Bianca and would like to get into that short distance. So Bianca, but Bianca's actually had the edge in the clinch. Three headshots and all three have come from that short distance. But Acosta is, that's where she wants to be.
Well, where she wants to be is into the final, Walton. 4 point gap. Acosta trying to come forward with that front leg. The Mexican, to her credit, trying to change the tactics. A punch from a bit far away there. And as Paul Green advised, to avoid grabbing the arm on the inside, those Gamjons going against Walton, and that adaptation, well, that's the sign of a champion, the ability to change. As the reverse turning kick round the corner there from Acosta, she changes the momentum of this match, and she'll get an extra point for that one as well, Sarah.
Yeah, growing up, watching Acosta fight growing up, and when she got into the final of the World Championships 2013, her spin kicks and her headshots were very good, and it's just come out there. She does need one more point.
Yep, and she will get that extra bonus point. The more difficult the technique, you get an extra point for the spinning headshot. So she needed it. She had to change it, Sarah, and to her credit, she's done it.
No, good, fair play to her. She needed to do something and not just stand there and take the shots from Bianca. But Bianca, she's the current double world champion, and, you know, she's got so much more in the bag.
Well, let's have a little look at this one here, Sarah. The reverse turning kick.
Round the back of the head there. Great option there from Acosta. Just asking the referee there to stop so she can add her extra point for the spin. Doesn't deserve the Gamjong for going out the ring either.
No, I agree with you on that, because that is the referee's speed of decision that's required. And the decision, well, they're going to have to review it here. It's taking a little bit of time. Too much time in our view. It should just be a simple point added on. But Acosta, well, she's got plenty of time. And we've seen so far, we know that Bianca comes out fast. There's no contention about this. Clean as you like, reverse turning kick round the corner. That's a four-point kick.
Yeah, Bianca will not be happy with that. She knows what to do now. She has a game plan.
So the more difficult the kick, the more points you get. Spins round the corner. Chris Codling, well, bedecked in the headphones there. Neidis Tavares agreeing with the Mexican coach. It's a good decision. And it will indeed be all tied up. If our mathematics is correct, it will be the point added. So it's 9-9. And the Gamjong for stepping out. As you said, Sarah, I agree with you. Unfair in my book, but it doesn't matter, to the delight of the British crowd. And it is Walden with the back leg coming on strong here. A minute and 30. Acosta, she's pulled herself back into this one.
With Gamjong now going to be very, very important. Just got to be careful in that clinch. No grabbing, no holding. This is where the action's been happening for the three rounds.
An excellent adaptation there from Walton. She didn't grab the hand in the inside, as you say, Sarah. Aware, as you rightly called it. As we see the overhead shot. But who's going to stay ahead here? The British crowd hoping for Walton. Acosta, the Mexican brawler here, working hard on the clinch in the inside, trying to push her way back into this one. Walton, by the merest of margins.
King Costa's definitely found a confidence in this last round and giving Bianca something. She's really making her work for this. Costa standing still. Is Bianca going to take advantage? And she does.
Well, Sarah Stevenson, the soothsayer there. I hope you've got your lottery numbers on. Of course, the fighters supported by the UK Lottery. And Bianca Walton's pulled out the bonus ball there. 13-9 with a big headshot. Timing to perfection. And the thing about Walton, she doesn't go on the back foot, she tries to, and the footwork round the corner there, lovely headshot attempt, doesn't score, but oh so close.
Yeah, unlucky there. Good option though from Bianca again, just putting something else into the mix there. Nice chop kick in the clinch, very difficult to do, but no score.
A little Gamjong snuck on for Acosta. Pulled it to 13-10. Can the Mexican find another headshot? She's got one shot at glory. Walton's footwork slips back, avoids the back kick. Good defence. Works the jab, works the stab, and gives a little fake too. Rare for Walton to go on the defensive. And we saw a nice spin kick attempt there from Acosta. But the Mexican, in the last second, is pushed to the floor. And Walton, a wonderful day at the office. And the crowd love it. Into the final, Sarah, much deserved.
Yeah, very much deserved there. Both players, very good fight. Both so experienced, you know, both decorated athletes. And it's just nice to see at the end there, the sportsmanship, both smiling.
And reasons to be cheerful for Walton. She marches on into the final. Acosta Briceda of Mexico, great credit to her. She made a real fight of it. There was the flying fist and the reverses of the Mexican. Walton looking a little bit tired, understandably, highly emotional effort. And of course, a little bit of time now to go back, recoup and recover. Walton wins it. Paul Green's coaching advice so crucial in that one, Sarah.
Yeah, definitely. It's great advice from Paul, and Bianca did everything that she asked him, that he asked her to do.
Walton, of course, the winner there. Confirmation, Acosta. Well, she was defeated in the end. Paul Green delighted. And Walton, likewise, she's the winner. And the final upcoming. Bianca Walton's into the final. The British athlete, the home favourite. Can she win? And who will it be against? Ida Bin or Alexandra Kowalczuk? A top-class battle in the offing here. Korea against Poland, completing the semi-finals here on day number two. The female heavyweight 67 kilogram final. They will be on their way to the mat in just a moment's time, but it's been a breathless set of action here in the copper box. And Bianca Walton there, Sarah, of course, in terms of preparation, is it munching on marshmallows, or is she into the fine nutrition, or does she not eat at all? Do you need to take on fluid? What's the plan between now and then
right
the final?
Right now, she's not got a massive amount of time to eat anything too big. So, again, if you're listening yesterday, it'll just be fluids, you know, hydration, a little bit of sugar, whatever that might be. We do have a lot of recovery products there as well, so I'm sure there's some high-tech products and kind of getting ready for the next match.
Speaking of which, Ida Bin, Grand Prix bronze medalist in Moscow. And there's her route through to this one. And nice use of the head guard there. A lovely moment. Alexandra Kowalczuk, ranked number 10 in this one. Did one better at the World Championships. And that big win there, Sarah Stevenson, against the Olympic champion.
Yeah, it's a great win for her coming into this semi-final match. Confidence should be high for Kowalczuk.
And the legs will be high as well. Kowalczuk, a noted head kicker, Ida Boone, a fantastic mover. Making sure they go in the right gate. Lovely moments there between volunteer and fighter. Ida Bin showing her confidence and showing her class in what is an eagerly anticipated semi-final. The last one here on day two. Not much to choose between these two, Sarah. Very similar level.
Yeah, very close, very similar level. Could be quite a cagey match. Hopefully not. It'd be nice to see some action, but understand why matches start off quite close, quite cagey, trying to figure each other out.
And of course, just figuring out there that the head guards need checked and ready. Of course, electronic sensors, if you're totally new to the sport, a very warm welcome to you. Electronic sensors on the socks, on the insteps. Well, Barbara Marion is not new to the sport. Our Canadian referee knows the way around the mat. Electronic sensors on the socks and on the heads. When they connect up with good power and good impact, well, those points were scored automatically. Sounds easy, but far from it. Kowalczuk, the tail of the tape, the longer legs. Can she use that distance? Ida Bin, the noted mover, Universiade champion, where she defeated Alexandra Kowalczuk. So they know each other well. And as we said, Ida Bin circling, trying to use that faking style. The taller of the two, Kowalczuk, just stock steady in the centre. Headshot just missing.
Yeah, I'm loving the movement there from Ida Bin. So, yeah, it's great. It's great action from the start. Even though they're not trying to score too much, it's quite interesting to watch. Moving around, trying to make something happen.
And Barbara Marion just making sure that the radio is connected. But there's been no connections with the shots, as you see. Sarah trying to make something happen. There is Ida Bin circling well. Lovely little shot on the inside. Well, we saw In Kyo Don, the heavyweight man for Korea, doing the same tactic.
Quite messy so far, though. Nothing really clean. But both trying to make something happen. And a nice point there from Kowalczuk. Underneath the guard, no cover from the Korean athlete.
Ida Bin left a space. And Kowalczuk, well, she certainly exploited it as we move into the last minute of this round, but it is the Korean, as we talked about, following up after the first technique and lands it nicely. Big punch there from a distance as well. Claimed it, scored it, and she has the lead.
Not quite enough there on that punch.
Both fighters into that open stance now, trying to draw the back leg forward. Good little shot there from Kowalczuk on the way through. And good news for the pole.
But Idar being fallen into that shot there, making it quite easy for Kalal Shuk to score.
Well, a close contest so far. 20 seconds in the first. Idar Bin tries to flick a little soft shot round the corner. Back kick almost leaves the space for the headshot. And the dying embers of this first round. Been decent from the pole. Kalal Shuk crams those big long legs in under the guard of Idar Bin. Steals the tactics of the Korean and steals the lead as well.
It's a good first round, I think. For me, Idar Bin came out, you know, with good confidence, good movement. But Kalal Shuk, for me, has the second intention. The first one's a little bit big, you can see it coming a little bit. But the second intention is where she's scoring her points.
Well, eyes down, looking. Idar Bin against Alexandra Kalal Shuk. Idar Bin just taking as much time as she can on her seat. Kalal Shuk didn't sit down at all. Vaults over the rostrum there. No Yong-gu, formerly a coach of Great Britain, in the corner of Idar Bin, in the corner of Korea now. And is the taller of the two, the pole that has the advantage. Idar Bin has the movement. Can she work on the inside? Interestingly, it's been the pole that scored. With attempted spin kick.
She has a lot of techniques there, Idar Bin, but they're just not connecting. She just needs to get her distance right, get her timing right. Yep, again, a little miss there, but try to recover.
Yep, again, recovers nicely, as you
the
say there.
The left-hand punch again. 2 points so far for Idar Bin with the punch.
And there's a nice little punch under the body armour there. Pops it into the guard. Front leg counter lands cleanly. And Kalal Shuk, well, she's got the longer legs, but that concentration, she's picking it up nicely. Liking the intensity of Kowalska, just saying to Idar Bin, come on forward. And picking her off, anticipating it nicely. The punch from downtown, missing wildly. And Idar Bin, a little bit reckless here, last minute in the second.
She's still trying with that punch, not all the time. And for me, it's not quite there. But Kowalska just gave her a little warning before to let her know I can punch as well. She has got that right hand there, ready and waiting.
Of course, taekwondo, the art of kicking and punching and movement as well, but the balletic style of Idar Bin hasn't paid off. She's been circling, but with no real intent in this second round here.
Idar Bin, for me, struggling a little bit with the distance on the first shot. So using that first shot to kind of try and make try and open up something, trying to create something to happen, but it's not quite working for her.
Well, it hasn't worked to any effect, as you say, Sarah. And the biggest result for Kalal Shuk, she's going to get out of this second round with a 4-point gap. Handy lead for the pole. Difficult for Idar Bin here, Sarah.
It is. I think for me, Kalal Shuk knows that Idar Bin is going to come and try and come into the distance with maybe a poor first action and two shots. She's fell onto the front leg of Kalal Shuk, and Kalal Shuk has got 4 points from literally doing nothing, just holding a leg up, waiting for it to fall into that front leg.
Well, she's fallen into the trap a few times. And who's going to get their feet into the final in this one? Adamczyk, a former fighter as well from Team Poland. Converted into coach. Well, you mentioned that, Sarah, it's so important for former athletes to make that transition.
Yeah, it's great to see so many, you know, ex-elite athletes now sitting in the coach's chair. So many that have been around the same time as me, inspiring for the next generation coming through.
But who's going to come through this one? Ida Bin came into it potentially as a minor favourite. But the tactics of Kowalczyk have been excellent, and the concentration and anticipation picking off the Korean as she comes in. But picking off a little power punch there, Ida Bin pulls herself back into this one.
She got a distance there, but good cover from Kowalczyk. I was going to say that both these athletes have not had the best cover, but just trying to, they're trying to use their movement, staying clear of that second action.
And staying clear of that headshot there. There's the spin that we mentioned. What a counter on the way through there. Kowalczyk missing by a whisker with that front leg to the face. Well, the Korean coach, No Young-goo, trying to advise his fighter to come forward to motion to try and draw out a response. But the calmness of Kowalczyk, she's been excellent, Sarah.
She has, yeah. I mean, Ida Bin is actually, she's trying to move, trying to force a reaction, but not really able to capitalise. That's, again, that's the third, fourth time she's fell onto one of her front legs there. So I think she's a little bit scared. She is trying to make, Ida Bin is trying to make something happen, but for her to then rush in with no cover, knowing that Kowalczyk is going to lift that front leg up, she's probably going to be really frustrated with that.
Well, frustrations for the Korean fighter. She's been her own undoing, and she's trying to claim these punches, but there's not much power on them. Steps through with a back kick, but I'm impressed. Kowalczyk using that front leg really well. Nice little adaptation there. Ida Bin steps round the corner, lands a little two-pointer into the last 15 seconds now. Kowalczyk on the defensive. Ida Bin takes the gamjon. Two-point game now, and I think we're going to see a protest. Just not wanting the Kyungo, or the Gamjon, I should say. Kyungo's a thing of the past. No Young-goo, the man in the middle. No Gamjon. Wasn't pulling. I'm sure he learned some English when he was over here. I know him very, he was a good friend of mine.
That might be the limit there, I think.
Yeah, not the most studious. So, of course, this one, well, it's all to play for. Stands at 12-10. The Gamjon could bring it back to a one-point game. Tension here. And the only person that will be delighted is Bianca Walton. The longer this one goes, the better.
Yeah, the longer rest she's going to have. See now in the video replay what this, maybe what he's trying to ask for.
Well, he's saying that it wasn't a hold, it was a push. You're allowed to push under the new rules.
Yeah, I mean, from this angle, it did look like push rather than a hold, but we didn't see her left hand. Maybe there was something happening that we didn't see.
Sure, well, the referee has the best vantage point, as does the adjudication panel. The trio having a look, unsuccessful. Good news for Kowalczyk, not so much for Ida Bin and the pole. Well, she's in pole position now, lands another shot, and it's a tale of tactics. She'll happily take this gamjon if she has to. Barbara Marion duly gives it. And the clock is going to defeat the efforts here of Ida Bin. Kowalczyk kicks, covers. She'll take another one. Ida Bin. Over anxious. And it's all over Barra shouting. Headshot to finish there from Kowalczyk. A bit of class there from the pole. And one thing's for sure, Bianca Walton is in for a real match here.
Yeah, excellent there from Kowalczyk. That front leg was just dominating the whole three rounds, especially the last round there. And if I was Ida Bin, I'd be a little bit frustrated. I mean, she got caught with far too many running into that front leg of Kowalczyk. But Bianca will know now, beware of that front leg. Watch when you're rushing in, have good cover. Work the clinch, which she's been really good at.
She has indeed.
And she's got better movement than Kowalczyk, but Kowalczyk I don't think is going to be fazed. She looked very calm in this match. So we are in for a good final for our heavyweight girls.
We are indeed, and there's confirmation. Kowalczyk will be up against Bianca Walton. And a winning smile there from the pole. A polished performance. And she advances. Top class there. And it is Walton who awaits. Well, here we go. The first final for your entertainment, the women's under 57 kilogram contest. Jade Jones against Earum, a top class battle. Earum, the winner in the World Championships against Jones. Repeat or revenge? An awesome ovation for an awesome athlete, Jade Jones in fine form, and Charlie Tubby walking it in there, world rank number one. Will she be on top of the podium at the end of this one? There's a route through, big win against Mäkinen, and very impressive against Skylar Part, which we'll discuss in just a moment. Earum looking calm and composed. World champion in 2017, the only title that Jones doesn't have. I'm sure she won't want me to remind her of that one, Sarah.
No, I don't think so. Very frustrating for Jay, but she'll get there one day. She has all the attributes, but no one can ever take away the double Olympic gold medals that she has got. We can't have everything.
Exactly, you can't have everything. Where would you keep it? And keeping the fans entertained here in the copper box, just whacking his dad there or supporter on the way through. Lovely to see a very popular fighter indeed, Jade Jones, keeping it in the family there. Big moments for both female fighters, the fantastic Flint Army, the Welsh wonder.
There's Jade's mum there, and her grandma and her granddad, who I know, she is so indebted to them, both in particular.
Yep, you're absolutely right. A little bit about her background, Sarah.
Yeah, she always praises her grandma and granddad. You know, if it wasn't for them, she wouldn't be here today. And she, you know, she's so good at giving back to them. They're so proud of her.
And reasons to be proud for certain. Just asking for a little bit of ice on the back of the neck there. But who's going to be ice cool in this one? Under 57 kilogram. It is the final, and it is a repeat of the World Championships. Earum emerged victorious in the quarterfinals. Kick Jones in the head, which is not a wise thing to do. Will she get a revenge here? Dania Gonzalez Cancino from Chile, she's in charge of proceedings for this one. The real tension here, of course. The silence gives way to the Kia and the shout. Jones trying to come forward. And it's a good shot there. Lands cleanly.
Excellent shot there by Jade. That'll give her a real confidence boost in this first round.
Yep, very much a come-forward fighter. Loves to take the lead and hold on to it. There's Jones, but Earum trying to make some room for herself here in the middle of the mat. Good blocking there from Jones. She's full of concentration, and they have started as they finished in that World Championship match.
Earum really trying to keep up that high intensity that Jade has, giving Jade so much to think about.
And likewise, Jones trying to enter the thinking space and the kicking space of Earum. Good footwork back from the Korean in red. Back leg turning kicks from Jones. Adaptation as we were on the score.
A little bit there of a knee block from Earum, but not noticed by the referee. Great punch, good effort, but no points.
A little gamjon though for pulling on the inside. And the crowd enjoyed that one. Jones, the picture of intensity. Earum, likewise. A minute gone in this first round.
Both players at the moment just cancelling each other out. Taking a little bit of a rest. You switch off, you get kicked in the head. Great shot there by Jones.
Perfect timing there. The headshot makes the difference. And she's gone ahead. Is she grabbing the leg on the way through there? Doesn't make eye contact with the ref. Earum, she doesn't have her problems to seek here in this pulsating opening round. Big punch from Jones. Headshot over the shoulder. Lands both. Lands clean. And lands true. Jade Jones, 11-2.
Excellent start by Jade. You can just really see she's got that fire in her belly. It's great to see her back.
No question, and she's fired a few shots into the belly and the head of Earum as we begin to the closing stages of it. It's been a very good first round. A little bit of a gamjon there on the inside. 11-4, 7-point game. Last 10 seconds. Jones, defensive. Lovely push kick. Crowd loving it. And lots to celebrate for Jade Jones. Far from over, though. Earum will have learned. Well, she's up against, as Sarah Stevens has said, Jade Jones back at her best, and she goes back to her coach. Great start.
Oh, she's so strong there, so powerful, high intensity. Earum mixing it for the first half of that first round, but Jade just took advantage of every little switching off from Earum.
And speaking of intensity, speaking of fighting spirit, I'd like to talk a little bit about a former teammate of ours, Sarah, and a great friend who sadly passed away, Caroline Fisher. The British Taekwondo Federation are going to announce a scholarship in her honour.
Yeah, everything about Caroline we're going to put into this award. So, for me, she has so many amazing attributes. She's sadly missed by everyone in world taekwondo, especially everyone here in Great Britain, and from her club at Scorpion Taekwondo. So, if you believe you have the attributes of Caroline Fisher, then please get your nominations in. Look on the British Taekwondo website. Get them in before the 17th of November. And you'll win you are the lucky winner. You'll get £1,000 towards your competition fees for next year.
Well, big prizes at stake and a big honour indeed to carry that name. But carrying the lead here, Jade Jones, she's extended it. Lovely little shot there. Earum caught in the headlights a little bit here, and Jones trying to stay aggressive, doesn't want to change her tactic too much, does so, leaves a space, and it's room for manoeuvre now for the Korean.
Excellent punch there by Jade. Again, not leaving it there too long. Punch, score, let's go for the headshot. Second intention straight away.
And as you say, the second intention, she's been full of intent, has Jones. She started ferociously here, has the fighter from Flint. Good back leg attempt there from Earum. Still in this contest, but needs to get something going soon. That gamjon will not help.
Jade really worked on that close distance as well. Just switched off there a little bit. Caught under the guard by Earum.
And indeed, she has to be on guard. Cuts it to a 16-8 deficit now. Earum back in this one, trying to work her way through. Jones warding off with that front hand, the hand closest to her opponent. Push kick there, lands a little low. Referee doesn't bother about it. And it eats yet more precious seconds. 50 to go in the second.
Good movement there by Jade, just out of the distance.
Controlling proceedings nicely. Headshot attempt there.
Yeah, a good attempt. No points. Maybe wasn't quite hard enough there. Didn't connect quite so clearly, but good option there for Jade. Earum just looking a little bit confused as to what to do. Nothing's quite working. Jade's reacting to everything that she's done, that she's trying to do.
And she's reacting very positively. Good footwork on the shuffle as well from Jones. Push kick round the corner, lands it clean, changed the angle, landed the shot, a buckle of the knee there from Earum, who's looking a little bit leg weary now. A tough time against Jones. 11-point gap. And this second round, well, it's gone the way of the first, and it's gone the way of Jade Jones. Excellent performance, Sarah.
Great performance by Jones there. Earum just didn't really know what to do, and I don't really know what she can do to pull this back, but really, really great to see Joan back in the game again. This is where she thrives, in the final on the big stage, and that's what a true champion can do.
And speaking of a true champion there, she takes a drink of water. We'll see some of the good shots that she scored with. Her fitness looks to be back.
Her fitness is there. She's dominating this match. She doesn't look tired at all. Earum just lost a little bit of power there. Legs look a little bit like jelly, and Jade just wearing her down with her high intensity and her fitness and her strength. Jade's always been so strong with that front leg,
and that strength of course manifests itself very rarely injured as well. Jones, a strong fighter, made of tough stuff. The fighter from Flint has family with great support, and here she goes in this one, the crowd favourite here in the copper box. And a lovely overhead shot there. You can see what it means to both fighters. They're going to have to work so hard here. Earum more than Jones. But credit to Jones, sticking with the game plan, stabbing and spoiling, closing the distance and closing in on her first Grand Prix gold medal for this season.
Gamjung there for Jay, holding in that short distance. As I said, she has improved just over the day within that short distance. So that's, for me, a sign of a true champion, that you can actually adapt your game on the day. Another for 2 points there, two body shots for Jay, 4 points under the guard of Iarun.
Yeah, as you rightly say, under the guard, the space exploited, and Jay Jones, well, she's working to great effect here. Footwork first, the order of the day there. Lovely jabbing stab shots forward, just giving Iarun, and a slip round the corner. That was done to her in the last Moroccan Grand Prix by Turkey. She threw the back kick, left the space, the Turk slipped round the corner. Jones has taken it, adapted from it, learned from it, and giving out a real lesson here. Jones in the ascendancy, last minute here, Sarah.
She's absolutely loving this, you can see. She's not tired, she's enjoying herself. And when Jade's enjoying herself, she is just thriving. Ooh, and a nice back leg headshot there by Iarun.
Yep, a boot, an old school boot to the face there from Iarun. A loss of concentration for the merest of moments. And Iarun puts a little bit of respectability on the score. But Jones deserving this lead, Sarah.
She, yeah, exactly. That front leg is just too strong. She's wearing her down. There's nothing she can do. She's, Jade is reacting to everything that Iarun is doing.
Well, there's no room at the end for the Korean. Iarun tries with a little shot. Jones picks off to the head, doesn't score. Credit to the Korean. And she's putting on a final charge here. But it's Jones in fine style. Wonderful little push kick to the body. 31-14 in the third. Well, she couldn't get the gold in the World Championships. She took silver in the last Grand Prix. And it's gold this time in the copper box in London, to the delight of mum and dad. Jay Jones, Grand Prix champion. Wonderful style. And what a way to finish. Crowd love it. Friends and family elated. And it's a great win for Jones. Sarah Stevenson, what a wonderful performance.
Absolutely incredible by Jones. Yeah, just so inspiring. Just great to see her back on form here. She needed this. She needed this win towards the end of this year. She's ready for the Grand Prix final now. The crowd are loving it.
And rightly so. And rare bit of emotion there from Jay Jones. Iarun never in the contest, let's be fair. The Korean tried, but from first to last, it was Jones in the ascendancy. And she takes the adulation of her friends, family. She's even got time for a little autograph on the way out there.
Yeah, she's loving this, Jade. Jade doesn't settle for anything other than gold. Even if she would have had a great fight, I don't think she would have been signing autographs there. She loves to win.
She does
don't
indeed.
We all?
Yeah, for sure. Winning in fine style. And it was high fives all round in a high-scoring contest. And Sarah Stevenson, have a look at some of the quality here. Grumpy champion Jay Jones.
That front leg of Jay just keeping her away all the time, always having an answer. Keeping that distance, moving back, working that short distance, working that clinch. Again, she's improved that so much just over today. Nice headshots there in the clinch, in that short distance. So from being not so great in the clinch, from being able to actually score in that short distance.
Well, the highlights make good viewing for the British fans. Jones advances with the gold medal. Top of the tree. Jay Jones from Wales. What a wonderful way to win. Headshot from Iarun. Undeterred, Jones the champion. Well, of course, after you've worked as hard as that, you get to have your just rewards. A high-class performance from all four female fighters in the under 57 kilogram grouping. And Jay Jones, fresh as a daisy.
Yeah, you are. It's miraculous how fresh you are when you've won. You forget that you're tired. But Iyaru looking very, very tired. She did work hard. She just, Jade had an answer for everything. She just couldn't get round her legs. She couldn't do anything about Jade. She was just on form today and on fire today.
And nice to see Jade Jones smiling again. It's been tough times. The Olympic hangover, so to speak, took the biggest crown in the sport. A slight slump in form, but she's dragged up that motivation. She's put the training in and pulled herself back to the top of the world tier. Dejected Iyaroom, delighted Jade Jones. A feeling that smile will be with her for a few days, Sarah.
Yeah, it will be, I'm sure. She made it with that. We'll see you tomorrow. Give her a big hug, say congratulations. I'm very proud of her. We're all really proud of her. It's great to see her back.
Well, speaking of being back at top of the world, Sarah, you coached her at the Youth Olympic Games back in the day. That was the start of the journey.
Yeah, I coached her at the Youth Olympic Games qualifiers. It was great. It's great to see her from where she started to where she is now. I'm sure she still has some of those traits, but sometimes you need that. You need to keep that going with you and to never lose who you are.
Well, Tatiana Kudashova showed who she was, gave it plenty. Kowalczuk likewise from Poland, great performance from her. Ida Bin Iyaroom, wonderful effort there in the under 57 kilogram grouping. Credit to her for the effort. Grumpy champion. Well, the winning smile from the champion and turns to take the adulation of her family as well, Sarah.
Yeah, and again, for me, Jade Jones is probably the biggest name right now in taekwondo, Olympic-style taekwondo. Jade's name is well up there.
She was well and up there in terms of performance. Yeah, yeah, you're saying rightly so. And she will receive her just rewards. A nice little $5,000 bonus. And there's confirmation. Adamkiewicz and Kudashova with bronze for Poland and Russia. Iyaroom with the silver. And it is Great Britain's Jade Jones on top of the world. Grand Prix champion. And the flighter from Flint. Well, she is back with a vengeance. Well, of course, that completes the female under 57 kilogram grouping. And we will move on to the men's under 58s and let's see what they have to offer. But of course, the fans here in the Copper Box in London offering their respect to all four, but to one fighter in particular. Jade Jones victorious and in fine style.
Jade's mum there, very proud. Huge smiles from Jade's mum and dad, her family.
Her brother as well,
giving
yeah.
Giving her a hug, who's also part of the Great Britain squad up in Manchester. Bright future ahead for Luke Jones as well.
Yeah, we'll look out for him. But for the moment, there's your champion. Oh, the glistening gold for the Welsh wonder. What a way to perform. Lauren Williams yesterday, Jade Jones today. And Iyaroom happy with her silver as well. And we are happy to say congratulations to all four of the under 57 kilogram grouping. They treat us to some great matches. Let's hope that the men's final in the under 58s can do the same. Enjoy that one, Sarah.
Yes, very much so. Bring on the next one.
Well, there is the next one for you. The men's under 58 kilogram final. Arman Hadipour of Iran against Mikhail Artamonov of Russia. Armin Hadipour, Selhaladi, world silver medalist Abigail Lowe. Big moments for her. Well, the stern face, Mikhail Artamonov, very composed, very focused, skillful fighter as well. Lost by a point in the World Championship final, won by a golden point in a bit of a snooze fest against the Spanish fighter, Jesus Tortosa Cabrera. But in this one, Sarah, I'm guessing that we're going to have the same patient approach.
I mean, from the start, there's always that to start with, but for me, Hadipour has a little bit more intent with his actions, forcing action to actually happen. So we'll see if he starts a little bit faster than in Artamonov's previous match.
Well, we had Kudashova, she fell over. We've had Hadipour's got a little bit more. You're doing well with these, Sarah.
I've done none of those. They're all yours.
You don't want to take the blame
I'm
for that.
I'm not claiming any of those.
Well, who will claim success in this final? Under 58 men's. It's always a different reaction. Do you wave at the camera? Do you pretend that it can't see you?
Seen a few of our junior squad there. Mason Yarrow there giving us a little wave, heading out to the junior Europeans in a couple of weeks.
Yep, Cyprus bound in November. Will they come back with medals? You've got plenty to learn from in this one. Armin Hadipour Selahani, the Iranian, very composed fighter. And Sarah Stevenson has told us in her expert analysis, a trademark of Team Iran, calm under pressure. But will Mikhail Artamonov bring anything to the party here? Huang Jinhuan from the USA in charge of this one. Oh, we've seen a few golden point rounds. So we could say it's 3 times 2 minutes. It could be an extra bonus round as well. But let's see how this one plays out. Haven't fought each other before.
Let's hope no one finishes with 5 seconds to go. I don't really know if you get away with that with Iran.
Exactly right, Sarah. And speaking of time, the referee just making sure the clock had started. It has indeed. Hadipour, he's in blue. Artamonov, the Russian, in red. And he's trying to hold the centre of the mat. And that hop forward style always finishes it with a kick. Doesn't want to take a gamble on Hadipour. And drags it down the way as well.
Hadipour just letting him know, I'm here, I want to control this match. Good start from him. No points yet, but it's good to see him trying to control the match.
Yeah, as you know yourself, Sarah, in your World Championship victory, and in your illustrious career, always dominating that space, making sure that your opponent earns any sort of millimetre of distance.
Yeah, giving you the confidence and putting them on the back foot is the best place to be in. Being in the middle of the ring, controlling that, calms you down a lot more than the opposition.
Yep, the psychological battle, the fight within the fight so far, ebbing and flowing. Artamonov trying his best to creep back in, but Hadipour, true to form. A change of stance this time. He's an incredibly flexible fighter, the Iranian. Close with that.
Yeah, excellent option there. Back leg with the chop kick. Just falling a little bit short. But putting Artamonov under a lot of pressure here. But it doesn't look phased. There's a stern expression. Still looking quite confident.
Yep, decent start from both men here in this under 58 kilogram final. Yet to come to the boil, but simmering away nicely into the last 20 seconds or so.
Again, we're seeing the excellent cover here from Artamonov. Trademark from the Russian athletes. Really, really difficult for Hadipour to score, but still keeping that pressure on. Staying in, I suppose, his control. Maybe not control on the match.
But neither man grabbing control of the round. End of the first, nothing to report. Other than the fighters running through the database in their mind, they've never fought before. So now they know a little bit more about each other.
A nice round for me. I like to see a lot of movement, trying to create space, trying to create options. So it's really, really good to see that while still exploring and, as you said, collecting that information.
information. They're now discussing in the Russian corner. Of course, it's a debate for coaches. How much information do you give to the fighter?
I think, for me, you should work with that player, figure out how they want that information, how much information, how little information. If you want more, tell your coach. If you want less, tell your coach. Or if you trust your coach enough, it'll naturally just happen. But as you get older and more experienced, you should be able to tell them how you like it, how you want your information. For me, the little as possible, please. I can't do too much at once.
Well, you did too much with your feet to need any coaching of note. But who can find a shot of note in this one? 0-0, Hajipur tries with a little front leg, gets closer to the body protector this time. Atamanov just being dragged into this one. Hajipur giving him a little look and saying, right, come on, let's get the fight going here. But the patience of Atamanov evident, because he knows the flexibility is there from Hajipur.
Hajipur has trying the second action now, flicking to the body, and I think, like you said, Atamanov knows he could take that second and third action high, so just steering clear a little bit. But his Artamanov's cover is just unbelievable. It's so hard for anyone to score on.
And because of that style of covering there, Hajipur threw out a back leg turning kick. Very unusual for him to open up so quickly in this one. Of course, back leg takes longer, leaves a bigger space, and almost exploiting it there. Artamanov kicking himself, but not quite kicking Hajipur. And this one's yet to kick into gear. Last little push kick there from the Russian, trying to control a bit of real estate here.
Artamanov really trying to get edge that little bit closer. He's not as wary of that distance now. Good cover.
Both men giving a good look at each other as we have a little look at the score. The only thing that is changing is the clock. No ganjons, no points, and no kicks of note here. This final yet to come to life, but both men, well, we called it on the way in that they would be patient. Will that patience pay off? Change of stance on the back foot there. Got close with that one, Artamanov. But close doesn't get it done. As we run into it, there's the back leg turning kick again. No shortage of effort, the drag down shot from the Iranian as well. 0-0, it's as we were.
I'm really impressed with Artamanov's patience, as you said, John. It's just, he's not fazed by anything. He knows he's got good cover. He knows he's got good movement. He's good at avoiding the shots. He's just waiting and waiting and waiting for that right opportunity. Even if it's 1 point, a gamjung, he's patient and he's ready.
And actually, we might look at kicks and think, oh, you know, that's tough, that's aggressive. It's actually quite aggressive to just stand there with the world watching and not do anything.
Exactly. I think both athletes are really, really good at that. Being able to stand in that middle distance, knowing what they're good at, ready for anything, and very, very patient. That is an art, and these two have got that down to a T. And even though nothing's happening, it's not a snooze fest, as you like to say.
Nice one. Cause for alarm. Who's going to waken this one up here? Will it be a festival of footwork and kicking instead? Hajipur. Well, it's not been a poor start from him. He's been good. Cover's been good, though, from Artamanov, cancelling each other out. But it only takes one to get it going here. It could be a gamjon that sets this final alight here. Men's 58 kilogram contest here. Hajipur in blue. Artamanov, well, he's the Russian, and you can see for yourself what colour he is in as he steps back there, almost leaving a space to the body protector. But it's as we were.
Some good, really good realistic fakes from Artamanov. Just subtle little movements, but realistic enough to get a reaction for Hajipur. Not quite making anything happen, but enough to be threatening.
Well, of course, we're watching it with the eyes of spectators, or in your case, commentating and analysing. But when you're in there as a fighter looking at someone who's constantly moving, it gives you moments to pause and reflect.
Yeah, you have to react. It's just those little subtle movements, but realistic. You can fake as if you're going to kick, but it not be realistic enough. And for me, Artamonov is doing that really, really good.
He is indeed. He's holding the centre the best he can here. Well, we spoke at the start. Let's not talk about 3x2-minute rounds because we could go to the golden score. It's moving that way at the moment. Iran or Russia, who's going to grab the ascendancy here? Last 30 seconds approaching.
I'm starting to think Artamonov likes sudden death at golden point. And I didn't know anyone who did.
It looks like he's certainly trying to drag it into the deep waters and go for that golden score. Hadapur, he's trying to go and score a little shot of his own. We've seen everything in taekwondo, the high-scoring final of Jay Jones, where she was free and clear. Artamonov and Hadapur, well, they're happy to keep the distance between each other. Nice shot from Hadapur. Tries to go for it at the end. But we thought it might happen. Almost at the end there from Artamonov. But golden point it is. Well, of course, one kick or one punch will decide it.
I think it's always quite baffling to how you can't score. Either athlete can score a point in three rounds, but then more often than not, with 1 minute of one extra round, someone scores a point or creates a gam jump. It's fascinating, really.
Yeah,
but,
it's fascinating.
You know, they do manage to do it. They find a way to win, even if it's 1 minute and golden point.
Well, as you've talked about before in your analysis for the last set of the Grand Prix matches yesterday and today, match management so important to control your opponent. But now, as you say, no risk, no reward. We've seen converse ways to win. Win by punch or win by kick and fall over, as Bradley Sindon found out. He came so close to the fighter from Doncaster with the silver, but Abogosh nailed it. Who's going to have the tactics and the timing in this one? And off timing, it's just 1 minute to decide who's going to be the Grand Prix champion for 2017, Russia or Iran, Hadapur or Artamonov. The Iranian has been slightly more aggressive with the drag down shot, tries to go for it again.
Both athletes very, very focused, keeping a high intensity without creating too much action. Unlucky there.
Yep, ever so close with that front leg. Hadapur on the back foot. The referee going to give the gamjon for using the leg, holding it up without any intent to kick. Well, neither man has shown too much aggressive intent. Hadapur, to his credit, has tried. And if it goes to all tied up, it will be who has kicked the body protector most. Change of stance from both. Into the last 20 seconds. Headshot just sailing over the shoulder. They are so close for Hadapur. Artamonov on this hunt there. Tries with a back leg turning kick. Keeps the foot in. Last 10 seconds now. Artamonov looks at the score, headshot of his own, and it scores. What a shot in the last seconds. He grabs the Grand Prix Golden Glory point there, and I think we're going to see some sort of protest. Well, it's just the protestations from Hadapur, because Artamonov, well, you called it, Sarah. In fact, I think we will see a video replay, perhaps.
I was thinking, just get it up there, try something. Say he was holding, say he was grabbing, say he pushed. You know, you've got to do something to try.
But what you can say is he did try at the end. You said it all the way through. In the literally the last seconds there, headshot from nowhere.
Patience is a virtue. But it was actually a great match. I actually quite enjoyed that, considering there was not much action.
Well, as you said, Sarah, that patience paying off in the end for Mikhail Artamonov. Armin Hadapur had tried, he'd been aggressive. But then in the end, it is the Russian, who was in no hurry at all, who found that shot and finds himself as the champion. And of course, it came down to the final second, Sarah, and what a way to get it done.
It's a great way to win right at the end. Artamonov waited for that, you know, for 3.5 rounds, as we say, just for that one moment. Waited and waited in the clinch, in that short distance, took it high, 3 points. Grand Prix final champion here in London.
Yeah, Lansworth class. Incredulous look there from Hajipur. Absolutely gutted, the man from Tehran. But it's Moscow's finest. Matches on here. And we've seen a little bit of everything, Sarah, of course, in terms of high scoring intensity. This one a real stalemate, but lots of quality, because if you're a young fighter, learning that patience, it takes a lot to be as calm as that.
It does. I mean, it takes a lot of confidence. You know, to be able to do that is experience, confidence, and you only get that, you know, with trying to find who you are, you know, trying to find your identity. And both athletes there, they knew what they wanted to get out of the match. They were both trying to use that distance, use that timing, having good faking techniques, good cover, you know. A complete contrast, I suppose, to what you would think a minus 58 athlete should be doing. So, again, if you are a minus 58 athlete, you are one of the lighter weights, just shows they don't have to be doing something every 5 seconds. You can create action with just your body, with not just kicking.
Yep, that presence, that pressure. We talked a little bit about Jack Willey of Ireland. He was kicking, he was spinning. The next level up there, just a little bit, to add that patience in the distance. But by the merest of distances, in the end, Mikhail Artomonov emerges victorious. Hajipur Armin Seligani of Iran, to his credit, gave it all he could, tried to work for it, but in the end, the Russian deserving of that with the headshot to close it out. And that will close out the men's under 58. And there is, of course, a big heavyweight final in the offing. Bianca Walden of Great Britain against Alexander Kowalschuk. They will be hoping to go one better here. Of course, all four fighters making their way in. Jesus Tortota Cabrera and Tawin Hamprap. The Thai fighter quite clearly showing off a photograph of significance to him. And of course, the fighters bring their lives with them into the mat. Sometimes we forget that, we look at them as just athletes. There are important moments for Tawin Hamprap, clearly of significance to him, of equal importance in terms of his athletic career, is that bronze medal there. Well, Jesus Tortosa Cabrera, top class fighter, and it's another bronze medal for him. Make that three for the season in the Grand Prix road here to London, the Grand Prix final in Abidjan in the Ivory Coast. He'll be there. Can he go one better? One man who did, Arman Hajipur, couldn't have come much closer. But as you said, Sarah, the patience paying off for the champion.
Support here in London, the Iranian fighter.
Strong Iranian contingent. Well, King of the Ring is the man from Russia. Excellent performance. Kyle Artomonov. Nice little $5,000 prize. Well, he certainly cashed in with a top class victory. But who's going to hit the jackpot in the next one? There's confirmation for you. Tawin Hamprap and Jesus Tortosa Cabrera with bronzes. Iran's Armin Hadipur Seligani with silver. Mikhail Artomonov, the Grand Prix champion. Top class from him. Patience to the end and a nice headshot to seal it. That, of course, completes the men's under 58 kilogram grouping. And that leaves us with one set of finals to go. It is the female plus 67. As all four men take their just rewards. had a hard day at the office. A mixture of technique and timing, the tenacity and the patience. And all four will be in the Grand Prix final later in the year. And a smile there from Artomonov in the end. Just establishing dominance again there, standing at the front. And deserving of that title. His first Grand Prix title. He was ninth in the last two Grand Prix. So to make it up and get the gold, top class effort from him. And his moment to celebrate in front of the world's media. Mikhail Artomonov from Russia. Well, he's loving that one. Well, there's one more gold medal to go for. And there will be plenty of local interest. Well, we saw Jade Jones manage to execute a fantastic win. Can her friend, teammate and housemate do the same? Bianca Walton against Alexandra Kowalczuk. Well, they know each other pretty well. They fought at the Moscow Grand Prix. And in the quarter-final, Walton emerged as a 4-1 victor. So has Kowalczuk learned, or will Walton win again? The ovation tells a story as Walton strides in with Abigail Green, Olympic bronze medalist, double European and double world champion, ranked number one, and she's been on top form today. Well, Alexandra Kowalczuk, ninth at the World Championships, fifth place at the last two Grand Prix, including that defeat to Walton in Moscow, as Abigail Low Ireland helps to lead her in. But the biggest win of note there, Sarah Stevenson, Xu Yin Zheng, Olympic champion, defeated by Kowalczuk on form.
Yeah, she's had a great competition. Again, that front leg, it's a bit dangerous. Bianca's got to be careful not to walk onto that shot. I'm sure she's done her prep work in the back. But yeah, both these athletes have had a great competition, especially Kowalczuk, getting the final of
their
first Grand Prix.
Big step up in class, big step up in occasion, and big moments for Paul Green, the coach in the British corner. They've mastered their game plan so far. Barbara Marion just making sure that the batteries are in the whole group. And Bianca Walton looks fully charged and ready. She's going to have to be, Sarah.
Yeah, she's confident and she's ready. And yeah, I think for me, Kowalczuk has had a great competition. The confidence that she will have now going into this final will be at its peak. She should be in for a great match. Both athletes ready, focused. And Bianca, as we know, most of the time, straight from the off, straight in there, trying to dominate the ring.
Well, can she dominate proceedings here? The taller of the two, the pole. But who's going to have the bigger ambition? Renata Krawczyk of Croatia, a former fighter herself. Just making sure that Walton's body protector is all connected up. Of course, there's a little sensor in the back. You see the little silver dots? They're just an indication the sensors are on the inside. Likewise, on the head guard. Bianca Walton will be doing her best to cover up both, as will Kowalczuk. Crowd getting into this one already. Will they have more local talent to cheer and local victory? Walton against Kowalczuk, 67 kilogram and above final, and it's Kowalczuk that steals the tactics from Walton and steps forward, tries to take that centre of the mat. Walton covering well, Kowalczuk trying to be aggressive, trying to announce her arrival here on the Grand Prix stage.
A great option for Kowal's chuck, I think. If she didn't do that, Bianca was definitely going to take that. Definitely a gamjung there for Bianca. She knew that. I don't think she heard the referee there or saw her coming. So apologies there from Bianca, but still a gamjung.
And it's useful for Kowalska, that pressure paying off from the pole. Bianca Walton on the back foot. How often can you say that? Changes stance, looks for another option. But such a great match manager, she's going to have to be. Does well to cover the headshot there. And Alexandra Kowalschuk in fine form, there. Good response from Walton, chop over the shoulder.
Walton was still even though a little bit on the back foot. Gambling for both players there. Again, as Bianca was a little bit on the back foot, she wasn't fazed. And again, the exact same, letting her come into a distance. Come on into the distance, and I'll take the headshot. But again, two gamjungs there for holding.
Yep, Walton 7-3 to the good now, into the last minute here. She's got her tactics spot on, has come back into this. Kowalschuk started strong, but the taller fighter, hard to maintain that intensity. But it is Walton at the moment in the lead, and good value for it. Has got her footwork going as well now, controlling the distance. And Walton again, setting the pace now, into the last 30.
I think for me, Bianca's got her tactics down to a T. Kowalski isn't an attacking player for Bianca, allowing her to come into the distance.
But managing to land a little punch there as a response. It is Kowalschuk. As you say, tactics spot on, but the fighting spirit of the pole very much in this one. Last 10 seconds now, Walton with a headshot and a hook round the corner. Does really well. And you talked about it before, Sarah, the ability to score with that hook and evade as well. And she will now escape back to her corner with a very useful lead.
At the end there, first action high, didn't work. Second action, hook to the body and avoid, escape, be safe after. Perfect there from Bianca Walton at the end. A great round for her.
I thought we might have been able to hear a little bit of Paul Green's analysis there, but lots to be cheerful about. Those headshots, but as you said, Sarah, a couple of gamjons as well.
A couple of gamjons there for holding. I mean, for me, I'm surprised the coach from Kowalschuk didn't use his card. There was one definitely after a headshot there.
Reset the score in your head, build up the points, the advice there from Paul Green. We know that that jabbing front leg kick has worked well, but of course, well, Bianca Walton, you'll know her very well, Sarah. A chance to talk with her yesterday about her tactics, and she was saying that everything is a threat from the opponent. She's always super aware, and that served her well here. So in her mind, it's back to 0-0, which is why she starts so aggressively again. Kowalschuk looking a little bit more timid now, tries with a head kick of her own near the pole, but just a bit of concern now etched on the face of Kowalschuk. The headshot sailing past the shoulder, and Walton beginning to ebb and flow away here, Sarah.
Yeah, she's biding her time again, letting Kowalschuk waste her energy with a little bit poor distance. She has some good options. It's a little bit too slow for the likes of Bianca, who's able to just move out the distance and react or just leave it.
Well, it's the kicks that you miss that make you tired, and Kowalschuk breathing heavy now there. A swing and a miss, and Walton getting ever closer to this Grand Prix title. Kowalschuk, of course, still has plenty left in the tank, but beginning to look a little bit leg-weary now. Walton looks for that chop kick again on the inside.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think she listened to her coach, Paul Green, trying to say to her, try the chop kick in that short distance. Wasn't quite an option there, but she tried. Kowalschuk hopefully will be wise to that now.
A decent attempt at a back kick as well there from Walton. Circles round. Kowalschuk will leaves a space there, and Walton fills it. An excellent shot to the body. 13-4 now into the last 30.
That hook kick of Bianca Walton is really coming into her game plan now. It's actually becoming a strength. And that's the third time she's scored of that in the match so far.
Third time lucky. 6 points from those hooks. And she's come across a good fighter, Kowalczuk, up against it, almost giving it away. The headshot lands over, but I think Renata Krawajskic, the Croatian referee, is going to invalidate those 3 points. She had started the process of saying stop as we go into the last 6 seconds. Yep, a former fighter, the Croatian referee, wise to it there. But I think Paul Green, well, he was thinking about the video replay. He says, no, not this time. And we will roll on with the closing stages of the second round. Keeps the video replay card in his pocket. And Walton will retreat back with a 14-5 lead. Good stuff from Walton.
Yeah, great from Paul there as well. Why give Kowalczuk a break? There was no reason to play the card. She's in a comfortable lead. You know, I can't see Kowalczuk bringing this back. She's going to have to attack. And it's not really her strength. And Bianca knows that. She knew that. She got a lead. She's making her attack. It's making it really, really difficult for Kowalczuk.
Well, the atmosphere building here in the Copper Box, that's why Sarah Stevenson, our expert analyst here, talking about that hook kick round the corner. It's been worth 6 points so far. Well, the crowd providing the volume here, but it is Kowalczuk that is reeling and rocking at the moment. It makes really good viewing for the Partizan home crowd. Will they have another goal to cheer? At the moment, Walton in the ascendancy. Alexandra Kowalczuk, has she got anything left in the tank here? Here we go, third and potential final round. Hook kick again to start from Walton. And the footwork to boot, tries the headshot. Kowalczuk, to her credit, doesn't want to go down without a fight. And Walton all over it like a rash here. Great start from Walton. Renata Krawajskic given another gamjon there, but most importantly, that may have been the last chip and charge there from Kowalczuk.
Yeah, I think so. I think maybe, I don't know if she can deal with the intensity that Bianca's bringing. Bianca wants to go and win this in style, so let's get some more points, change up the intensity, as her coach Paul Green said, switch it up.
As we said, a very leg weary shot there, a big long punch as well from no real effect. Walton goes with the headshot, gets close, a punch in the head there from Kowalczuk on the way through, and the power punch from the pole, not to the protector, but wraps it off the jaw of Walton, and I don't think Bianca liked that one too much, but shows that calmness, Sarah.
Yeah, she's calm, she knows probably was an accident. I think if it was a little bit closer there could have been some fireworks, but she's calm, she's reset. A gamjung there for avoiding play.
Yeah, you don't look too convinced about that one.
I don't know, I think she was just moving around a little bit, didn't, and it wasn't, she didn't avoid for too long, but again, let's crack on.
Yeah, exactly, and cracking on in a cracking final with another top-class headshot. Kowalczuk has to eat it, and you cannot beat it at the moment. Bianca Walton even trying the lesser-spotted back kick there as well on the left leg. Good stuff from her, variety, intensity, and at the moment, she's headed to victory. Last 50.
Nice attempted headshot there. Chop kick reaction as you're coming in. Good in the clinch there from Walton. Kowalczuk trying in that short distance to use that front leg. Bianca trying out a left leg back kick there. Great opportunity for that. Didn't score.
But speaking again, of the score, 18-7 now. Walton in the ascendancy. The referee separates them. Perhaps for one last time, Kowalczuk, back leg turning kick, leg weary. That back kick that you spoke of, Sarah Stevenson, trying it. But Walton, wonderful performance. The last 10 seconds in the offing now. Well, Bianca Walton, she's won every Grand Prix so far this season. In Moscow, she took the gold. In Morocco, likewise. And here in London, well, Walton at a canter, hits the deck in the last few seconds. But she can manage a winning smile. Kowalczuk knows it's all over. And Bianca Walton waltzes to victory. We're going to have one little protest here. Well, unless the coach can find a shot that will get back 13 points in 2 seconds. Even he's smiling.
Why not? Give it a go. But I think Kowalczuk just wanted it to be over now. 2 seconds left. Let me get my silver medal and my $3,000, please.
It's not bad. Good day's work.
Good day's work. She's thought she's done well.
She has. Overmatched in this final. Prolonging the agony here for the pole. No question about it. Regardless of what this video replay says. Well, Walton will know deep in her heart. She's done enough to take the gold here. Well, we could analyse it, but it doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
Well, the tension doesn't really make any difference to the result here. More in hope than expectation. And her hopes have risen, and she's met the expectations of what it means to be a champion. Walton wins again in London. Wonderful champion. What a performer from start to finish. Walton waltzes to gold here in London. Superb stuff and wonderful scenes for friends and family alike. Wonderful from Walton. The champion again.
Absolutely perfection. Bianca Walton, champion here again on home soil. Absolutely amazing. A definite girl power day today.
Sarah Stevenson, you started the trend as Paul Green celebrates with his fighter there. Walton, what a performance. Got better and better as the day went on.
She did. She absolutely did. And got everything right in the final. She did not put one foot wrong.
And she put her foot in the face of Kowalczuk on plenty of occasions. Queen bee, no less. And she deserves that crown, along with the title of Grand Prix champion. Confirmation there, winner by a wide margin. And top class stuff from Bianca Walton. And of course, Kowalczuk gave it all she had, silver to the pole, but poles apart in the end. Walton, tremendous. And what a way to win. Sarah Stevenson, well, we've spoke about the tactics. Talk a little bit about the attitude that lets her do that.
Yeah, she's just grown so much. I think for the first time she won the World Championships, she didn't quite believe that could happen to her. And from then, she's just believed it and took it into every single match.
Well, she was the brightest star on a wonderful day for Great Britain again. Queen Bee strikes. And there was a sting in the tail at the end for Kowalczuk.
Bianca there, not giving up, right at the end, still trying to get more headshots. First action high, second action high. The hook kick there, avoiding safely out of that short distance.
And a left leg back kick on a couple of occasions as well.
Kick, yeah. Working so hard in the gym, adding extra skills to a tool bag. Nice little jab to the head there, just obviously. Not allowed, people. Do not try this at home.
Certainly trying her best, Kowalczuk, but in the end, Walton deserving of the victory, and she's the champion. Well, after all of that frenetic fighting, it's time for them to make their way to the podium in double quick time. The Fab Four. In the female 67 and above. Bianca Walton just checking there on the big screen.
Checking out her hair and her renown for a little red bow.
Yep. Bianca's bow. Well, she was the best by far. Nice little shimmy as well. And it was the footwork, Sarah. She moves well, she covers well, she does everything well.
She does, she moves really, really well. Just give us a little wing there, John, which was nice. She's a great athlete now, really embracing. She is a true, true athletic heavyweight world champion, Grand Prix champion, European champion, Olympic medalist.
She's done it all, and she's entertained us all tremendously here. And overall, well, what a competition it has been for Great Britain so far. Still more to come.
Still more to come, yeah. We've got more on tomorrow. But for the girls, three golds, absolutely incredible. Bradley Sinden, Cho Mahama, and more to come. So we've had a great weekend so far.
And enjoying her weekend as well there. Cressida Acosta. Give a good account of herself.
A dangerous athlete. She doesn't do much or enough sometimes. But when she needs it, she has something special. She just needs to see more of it, I think.
And speaking of seeing a little bit more, Alexandra Kowalczuk, a win against the Olympic champion, maybe took everything she had for that because, well, obviously Walton was the better of the two, but the pole just couldn't quite keep that power going.
I think as well, and credit to Bianca, I think Bianca took away all Kowalczuk's skills and what she was good at. So a great game plan from Paul and Bianca going into that final.
Yep, and executing the game plan with great style and finesse. Walton the winner again. Well, three times a charm. And of course there is a Grand Prix final coming up in Abidjan in the Ivory Coast. Walton will go in as the top seed. And she's top of the pile here today.
And a nice $15,000 so far.
Not too bad at all. And there's confirmation. Ida Bin and Bredis Acosta with the bronze. Kowalczuk with silver. And as you said, Stara going home with the check as well. Well, the interest accumulating and the interest evident here in the copper box. And whatever's happening back in the academy in Manchester in terms of fitness and conditioning, clearly working.
Yeah. Clearly having their porridge for breakfast.
Yep, the old kumquat salads as well. A healthy appetite, and she's sated that today with a wonderful win. And of course, wonderful scenes for Walton that she can celebrate. As you said, Sarah, lots to look forward to tomorrow as well. But it's all about today for Walton. She doesn't get tired of this.
Huge smiles there from Bianca. And she'll be back here tomorrow, supporting a teammate, supporting a boyfriend.
Yep, Aaron Cook, of course, by way of Moldova. He will be fighting in the men's under 80 kilogram grouping. And the female 49ers as well. So lots to look forward to.
We've got our very own Damien Sanderson tomorrow as well.
At 6 o'clock. Confirmation for you tomorrow. 6 o'clock local time for the final day of Grand Prix action. What a day it's been today. Lots to look forward to tomorrow.